Life's missing instruction manual. You, congratulations on your life. Your point of power is now. War, economic concerns, poor business, unemployment. It sure looks bad, doesn't it? But I also wanted to remind you that we have lived, survived, and prospered through the worst of times. For example, in 1780, George Washington said that we are without money and have been so for a great length of time. He went on to create an estate worth $750,000 when he died. In 1840, a traveler wrote, "So great is the panic and so dreadful is the distress that there is great many farms prepared to receive crops, some of them actually planted and yet deserted, not a human being to be found upon them." But we've got over that problem too. In 1857, editorial stated, "It is a gloomy moment in history. Not for many years, not in a lifetime of most men have to read upon this newspaper, and yet there's been such a grave and deep apprehension." That passed as well. That passed as well. In 1873, this country had a panic that shook the nation. A newspaper wrote, "All over the country, manufacturers are closing their works and discharging their operatives, simply because they can neither sell the goods that they make nor borrow to carry them until they demand for them their revives." Yet, we survived that panic too. In 1893, one man wrote of his troubling times he saw, "I have been through all the panics of the last 30 years, but I have never seen from which a distress so widespread and reached out to so many who had previously had been affected by this panic of 1893. And we got through that one too. We also got through the Great Depression of 1929, two world wars and Y2K panic, and even 9-1-1, even 9-11. What appears to be gloom and doom is often just the focus of the media. Conservative Gandhi once said, "When I despair, I remember that all through history the ways of truth and love have always won. The ways of truth and love have always won. There's been tyrants and murderers for the time that they can seem invincible, but at the end they always fall. Think of it. Always." I could go on and on. The point of life. The point of life. Life has always have been, it's had its ups and downs. The secret is to flow with the tide as best as you can. Complaining about it is what keeps you from spotting or even creating new opportunities. In every panic, there's a generation of men and women with eyes wide open and saw and seized opportunities. Whether it was George Washington, who went on to become the president and build his own fortune, or P.T. Barnum, who went to prosper during the Civil War. In fact, remain circumstances that don't make you. You make them. This bad time might become the greatest period of prosperity for you. Circumstances don't make you. You make them. Maybe you just have to relax to the demands. In 1941, Bruce Barton wrote, "I had been without a job 3 times in my life. Each time I made a survey of my surroundings and discovered that there was work to be done, though not the same kind of work I had been doing." Barton was the best-selling author of Congressman, popular speaker, and founder of one of the largest advertising agencies in the world, BBDO. He also became a millionaire. And don't fall the trap of the past from what was better of a present. In 1907, the famous tycoon John D. Rockefeller said, "People sometimes talk as if older men lived in a day of peculiar opportunity, and if there was no chance today for a young man to do what has already been done by my generation of men. And if all the avenues were closed, all the big things done, nothing could have been mistaken. Why, the time in which I opened my eyes was a midnight darkness, and this is a blazing noon. A word to the wise, listen, act, and prosper. There are opportunities around you. Which will you find and act now? Which will you see first and act now? The point of power of life is now. This moment is your time of blazing noon. I wish I had learned, Jim Edwards. I wish I had learned that I could do anything I really believe I can do. It may sound simple, but it's the basis of all the achievement, or lack of thereof, in anyone's life. As soon as I believed I could, and before that, I believed I could and I couldn't. But now I could. I believe that I can. And I can, and if you want to change your life for the better and change your belief about what's possible for you, what you are entitled to, and what you can accomplish if you simply put your mind to it, sure, it sounds obvious, but until you live it, breathe it, and make it a part of who you are as a person, you'll just be keeping what you've gotten in the past and keep getting what you've gotten in the past, which I'll bet isn't what you want. Start believing in yourself, and the world will change for the better, faster than you've ever dreamed possible. Jim Edwards, author of 5 Steps to Getting Anything You Want, www.howtogetanythingyouwant.com. You can be happy now. No one will believe you when you tell them this, but happiness is a choice. You can be happy right now. Yes, right now. How? With the decisions to be happy. You don't need money, though it would be nice. You don't need to be thinner, though you might like it. You don't need anything, though you might still want things. You can simply say, "I'm going to be happy right now," because you don't need money, you don't need to be thinner, you don't need anything. You could just simply say, "I'm going to be happy right now." This is the few trick known, because it didn't have the owner's manual for their life. This is the trick few know, because few people don't have this manual for life. Smile, be happy. If you're not happy, you're missing a great opportunity. Life doesn't have to be hard. Life doesn't have to be hard. Life doesn't have to be hard. Few know this unless that they read this manual too. Most people think that they need to fight and struggle. Not so. You can let life unfold. The secret is to focus on what you want. Do as before, which will make it happen, and trust that process. Yes, life can be hard, but it can also be easy. Most of the difference is how you look at what's happening. In regards of running a marathon is hard, you won't find very easy. You won't find it very easy. But if you enjoy running and consider a marathon a personal challenge you welcome, then you will regard running it as easy. Yes, you may sweat and struggle and pan along the way, but you'll enjoy it. And with everything else, the choice is yours. And as everything else, as with everything in the world and everything else, the choice is yours. You are behind your eyes. You are behind your eyes. As I was on my back on the doctor's operating table, it was minor surgery. So I awakened, the doc dug into my chest, cutting, snipping, cleaning in a wound that I had. It was no big deal. Not heart surgery or a lung transplant. Yes, I lay on the table wide awake and I felt as if he was working on a machine. I just happened to be in the machine. What he was doing wasn't happening to me, but to something that I owned. Take note. You have a body. You are not your body. You have a mind, but you are not your mind. You have emotions, but you are not your emotions. You are the being behind it all, able to choose what you want, able to direct it all. Choose wisely. The rest of this manual will help you. Your feelings are hidden thoughts. Your feelings are hidden thoughts. Feelings are shadows of thoughts, wrote by Michael Rice in his book, Why Is This Happening to Me? Again. Your thoughts create your feelings, but sometimes it happens in such lightning fast speed that you don't hear the thoughts as they whiz into a feeling. Your feelings inform you of a nature, of an impact that the energy of your thoughts on your psychology and physiology, writes Rice. If you are in pain, you are the one in error. Become aware. This concept will become clearer in the review of this manual of life for your life. For now, realize that your feelings aren't sneaking up on you unannounced, and they are not unavailable to your control. Your feelings are from your thoughts. Change your thoughts and you change your feelings. This will take some getting used to, but enjoy the process. Everything is energy directed by your thoughts. Energy makes up the entire world. You, me, this book, the chair you're sitting on, the room you're in, and so on. Energy. How you think begins to organize energy into form. For example, hold a negative thought in your mind for a few minutes and then go back in the mirror and you'll see a darkness around you. You'll probably have slumped shoulders, droopy eyes, and a frown. You've thought created the changes, which others will perceive as an energy change. Now, hold a positive thought for a few minutes. Go look in the mirror. You'll see brightness, your shoulders square, eyes twinkling, a smile on your face again. Your thoughts changed your energy. Thoughts begin at a change of energy in everything around you. Hold positive thoughts to help yourself and others. Lead happy, productive lives. You can't stop your thoughts, but you don't have to listen to them either. Your mind will keep working night and day, awake and asleep throughout your life. Good thing, too. You need it to help you walk, talk, drive, and live. But along the way, you'll notice some thoughts make you feel good, or other thoughts make you feel bad. Some thoughts will make you feel good, others will bad. Some will make you encourage positive behavior, others will encourage negative behavior. You don't have to obey all of your thoughts. A t-shirt I bought years ago had this saying printed on it. Meditation is not what you think. Exactly. Meditation is not what you think. Meditation is that space behind your thoughts. The more you can pay attention to the screen where the thoughts appear, the more liberated you will feel of them. This may not make sense right now, so just remember this. You can't stop your thoughts, but you don't have to listen to them either. Everything is a projection from inside of you. Everything is a projection from inside of you. You'll find that this is hard to believe at first, but everything in your life is a projection from the shadow side of your own mind. I told you this would be a hard to grasp, but I told you now, blame any excuses that are easy. Blame and excuses are easy, but they let you avoid responsibility. But your life is all about total responsibility. When you look around, all you'll notice and see within your own mind is how did you get there? From your own mental filters. To change anything, you must change the inside. This is difficult and to understand because most people don't have this manual. They have never been told in life what happens is from the inside out. When someone upsets you, they pushed a button within you. When a situation occurs that you don't like, it is drawn to from inside of your programming. Is this true? And it is. How do you change it? Well, you have to own the fact that you've attracted it, all of it. You've attracted everything. You then have to expect and accept the inside of you and release it. So if someone upsets you, look at how you upset yourself. Love it and let it go. So if someone upsets you, look at how you upset yourself. Love it, and then let it go. As you change your inner self, you will find the outer change. This is a big principle. Sit with it. Your nature is your current act. When I was in college, a friend of mine said that I was naturally pessimistic. He noted my sadness and glum look on my face and my constant complaining, and he concluded that pessimism was my nature. 30 years later, I was interviewed on a radio show, and the host wanted to know how my nature was so optimistic. She noted my smile, my light in my eyes, my constant exclaims of gratitude, and concluded optimism was my nature. Well, which was my nature? Both were my nature. Your nature is simply a role that you play based on your choices. Change your choices and you change your act. Do it long enough and you will seem like your nature. Your nature could be an optimistic nature. Wally Mentos, in the Results Book, wrote, "When you haven't got your role completely memorized, then you feel like you're acting. Have your role memorized. When you have your role memorized, it becomes a habit. You think it's your nature. If you want to change your nature, start acting in a new way. At first, it may seem awkward, and as if you were truly acting. After a while, it will become second nature, and everyone will assume that you were born that way. How to know what you want? Some people say that they don't know what they want. They're lying. You always know what you want. You may not want to admit it, though, but not even to yourself. When you state what you want, you neither have to start making it happen or have to start making excuses for it not happening. Sometimes it's just easier to say that you don't know what you want, but that's a lie. You do know, so admit it. No one is looking. No one is listening. So what do you want? You get more of whatever you focus on. People without this manual focus on what they don't want, and they get more of it. You're smarter than that, right? You want wealth. Focus on wealth. You want health? Focus on health. If you want happiness, focus on happiness. If your outlook but guaranteed secret of the universe, it's an overlooked but guaranteed secret of the universe, is you got more of whatever you focus on, and you get more of whatever you focus on. You want to be smarter? You want to be smarter than that, right? You want wealth? Focus on wealth. You want health? Focus on health. You want to have happiness? Focus on happiness. Whatever you say after I am defines who you become. I am, I am, I am. An important lesson of realizing that you create yourself by whatever you say of the words of I am. I am. I'm not talking about words you speak out loud, though that's part of it. I'm referring to the words that you say in the privacy of your own mind. I am fat. I am stupid. It may sound like assessments of who you are now. Actually, they are commands that led you to your current reality. Begin declaring who you want to become, and soon the words will become facts. I am. Whatever you attach to I am becomes your reality. I am, I am. What you love or want, whatever, what you love or what you hate will be drawn to you. This is the law of attraction at work, but basically the love that what you hate will be drawn to you. In other words, if you truly hate political parties as a way of life, you will find it everywhere. Your hate is an intense energy which will attract more of the same energy. By the same token, if you truly love something, whether a car or an activity, you will tend to draw more of that into your experience. The lesson is to choose your passions carefully. Knowing that you control the magnet will help you awaken you to your own power. Your body requires no assembly. Take a look in the mirror. Everything accounted for? Got some arms, legs, ears, eyes? Some people come with incomplete parts, but they can still have a terrific life. So don't worry about anything if parts look small or big or are missing. You're still okay. If you have the thing that you're a boy, if you have a thingy, you're a boy. If you don't, you're a girl. Either way, congratulations. You have what you need to have a good life. No assembly required either. Great hair, great day. My late ex-wife loved makeup, hairstyling. Her business card contained one of the one-line statement that said it all. Great hair, great day. The lesson here is to feel good about yourself. And that means nice hair or a nice shirt, so be it. The better you feel, the more the world will respond to you in kindness. Your memory will never be accurate. And your memory will never be accurate. You won't remember everything. You won't remember anything accurately. The best thing that you could do is take notes. When I spoke at an event in San Antonio on marketing, one of the greatest marketers of all time was in the audience. He was Ted Nicholas, one of the heroes and my mentors. I noticed that Ted took furiously and copiously throughout my presentation. Notes, furiously and copiously throughout my presentation. When I spoke at the end of Las Vegas, Jack Canfield, creator of the chicken soup idea, which became a series of best-selling books, was in the audience. He too took pages of notes. Neither of these legends had bad memories or lacked in success, yet they knew the value of taking notes. It helped them solidify what they were learning. It helped them have records and review later so they could refresh themselves of what they absorbed. In life, our minds will play tricks. You think you remember things? Even the key secret to this very manual, but you'll forget them within hours. And if you do recall them, you'll have interpreted them with your own spin. Take notes. Your memory will never be accurate. Love. Love will cause you to become disoriented in most delightful way. Enjoy it. It will last longer if you commit to it and not run from it. Love of people, pets, places, and even things is natural. When you are near the end of your life, you will look back at all that you've loved, and it'll make you smile. You'll want it. You'll like it. Sex. Sex. You'll want it. You'll like it. Find someone who likes to play the same way you do and enjoy it. Sex isn't bad. It isn't dirty. Sex without love is acrobatics. Sex with love is bliss. Food. Your machine body requires high-octane food. It needs every 3 hours. Not much, though. Just a little protein, a lot of vegetables, fruits, plenty of water, and you're set. Warning, eating foods as social activity is deceptive. You don't need extra fuel. Taking too much and your machine will get larger than your garage may be able to park. Exercise. You must exercise. Your body is the vehicle that carries you around your life. It needs maintenance. Moving your body keeps on running smoothly. Exercise doesn't have to be hard. Gentle exercise like yoga is just a valuable and intense exercise like rugby. The idea is to enjoy the exercise you choose. Exercise doesn't have to be long either. Do something every day for 30 minutes or 23 and a half hours are yours to do as you please. I've managed to lose over 70 pounds in 8 months. Keep it off. Keep it off, enter 4 fitness contests, and never miss a day of exercise. If I can do it after 50 years of struggling with obesity, you can do it. 3 life lessons I wish I had learned earlier. Dr. Paul Hartunian. Hartunian. When I look back, there are 3 lessons I've learned, each which have become solidly hardwired into my psyche. Number 1. There never was anything to be afraid of. The opportunities I passed up, or people I never approached, a rock star I never became, all sacrifices at the altar of fear. Fear that never really existed. Number 2. My worst decisions and actions happened when I was being petty or weak or self-involved, when I made less than kind comments about people, when negative outside influences affected me. Number 3. I am on the planet for bigger purposes than accumulated riches. 13 years ago, my life was permanently, profoundly altered by a dog named Milo. He put me on his entire different life path. Milo helped me see, and one of the major reasons I've been fortunate enough to accumulate substantial wealth is to use the money to help homeless, abused, and abandoned dogs. Milo also taught me humility. As I stand on a platform, having just finished giving a 90-minute talk in an audience of hundreds, getting standing ovations from the admiring crowd of getting a paycheck equally to many people's annual salaries, I clearly keep in mind that, all at the same time, on the next day, I'll be back in my yard, cleaning up my dog poop, left by a dozen rescue dogs now in my care. Thank you, Milo. Dr. Paul Hartunian is a famous speaker, author, and public expert. Read free of Ezine, Million Dollar Publicity Tactics, and learn how to get free publicity on the radio, TV, newspapers, and magazines anywhere in the world. Go to HTTP, go to www.hartunian.com/Ezine. Internal capabilities, understanding your life's potential. Anything is possible. The vast majority of people have no idea what they control, their experiences. Their mindset is that of a victim. It's easy to blame and shirk responsibility on this level. It's okay. We all have to start someplace. The next level starts up to play in the notion that life can be any other way. To begin the entertain, to entertain the idea that you can have and do or be more. Another level up from where you begin is to take the belief that we're not sure of what's possible. You play with the idea that your life can be better, or maybe even great, or maybe even your life can be better and great. And another level up from that, you know that anything is possible. You take on a mental power of deity and begin to realize anything and anything is truly possible. The only limits are the own mental ones. Go for the higher level. Anything is possible. You create your future with a pen. The secret of ages is that you can create your own future with a pen and your imagination. Here's how. Take out a paper and turn on your computer. Pretend it's 1 year from today. Write a letter to friend and have you accomplished all that you wanted to accomplish. Go into detail. Feel the joyous emotions and share that you thrill as you detail your success. This one single act, which you can do as often as you want, can command the universe to bring you what you need to make your new reality. It begins right now with a pen. Achieving your goal is easy. How to achieve your goals easily? You must know what you want. You must feel it, and if it's already, you must feel it as if it's already achieved, and you must do the next thing before you can achieve it. That's it. Easy, isn't it? How to achieve your goals is easy as that. The mind operates under its own conception. The mind operates under its own conception of itself. Better read again. The statement was made by A.K. Mazumdar. I have no idea from whom he is or where he is. I read the line in a book called Prosperity Plus by John Seaman Garnes. The man does the quote mean. Now what does the quote mean? Whatever you choose to believe will be the concept that runs your mind. What are you thinking right now in response to reading the concept? Minds operate under its own conception of itself. Whatever you answer, that is your current conception, and it is running your mind. Are you happy with what you are thinking? Get away from the dream that you are but of effect of something, and know that you are the cause itself. Francis Larimar Warner, Our Invisible Supply, Part 2, 1909. Get away from the dream that you are but an effect of something, and know you are the cause itself. How to feel better in 1 minute. Life doesn't have to get you down. There's a secret to feeling better, and within 1 minute, here it is. Breathe slowly, deeply, completely, and sigh. Here's how to do it. Take in a deep breath, fill your lungs, hold it for a few seconds, release it, long, slow, sigh of relief, and do it again, if necessary, repeat. The release of oxygen will help you release any stuck mood. A smile is universally understood. No matter where you go, what language you speak, everyone in all countries and countries understand the response to a smile. When we were in Italy, we ran into people who did not speak any English, but we can always smile and create a connection with the other person. When you are walking down the street and you see a stranger, smile. It can cause them to help them feel better about you, the world, their days. A smile is universally understood. Use it openly and often. It makes people curious. Exercise laughs like a child with milk coming out of its nose. Exercise. Laugh like a child with milk coming out of his nose. Laugh. Do it right now. Start laughing. Fake it at first. Push it. And the more how it starts, it rolls out. It takes its own movement of its own. Laugh 3 times. Deep belly laughs. Do it in traffic, in bed, in the shower, everywhere. Even right now. Do you need a reason? That's funny all by itself. You can laugh without reason. Go ahead. Show me. Your language can create attractors. Don't swear. When you swear, you send a negative vibration that tends to attract more negativity. Keep your word. When you say you do something and you don't do it, you teach others, including yourself, that you cannot be trusted. Watch how your words become reality. Everything you say tends to become manifested. When you say you can do something or can't, you begin to make the statement come to pass. Watch your language. Behind every behavior is a belief. Whenever you are confused about why you did something, look for a belief. Beliefs compelled you to do what you might otherwise think is stupid. The belief isn't stupid, it's just a belief. Change your belief and you change your behavior. Most people have no clue that their behaviors come from their own beliefs. They will want to blame others, the president, the economy, their family, friends, childhood, and so on. Blame is easy. It avoids responsibility. Recognizing all that a behavior is caused by a belief, which will help you select better beliefs for yourself. It will also help you understand others. Reclaim your self-esteem. Transform your self-talk from negative to positive. As humans, we are magnificent by nature. We possess the ability to overcome obstacles, achieve meaningful accomplishments, honor our most important values, and attain happiness and contribute our social and unique gifts to others. In short, we can take responsibility for making our lives optimally. Unfortunately, we go through a course of experienced lives through challenges. We often lose sight of these facts. From birth to continuing throughout our lifetimes, we encounter countless experiences that can either nor enhance our self-esteem or erode it. And they can either enhance our self-esteem or erode it. The challenges. Now, the process of diminishing our self-esteem begins when people observations of how somehow we do not measure up. We judge ourselves indifferent and deficiency in some way. We decide that we don't belong. From this point, we live in an unfold of accordance of our expectations. These expectations directly relate from how we feel about ourselves. Either we are worthy of all the good things in life that we can offer or deserving in pain of suffering because we lack value. When we judge ourselves harshly, we dramatically diminish our ability to merit love and achieve the success and abundance of the world reserves for those of the most valuable. When we base our actions upon beliefs, that lack from which we take deserves in rich relationships, material wealth, and happinesses, we trigger the very things from which we fear most. As our self-esteem assiduously continues to diminish, we find ourselves incapable of directing our lives and fortunes productively. Resignation sets it like a dry, hot, killing our spirits. This ensures that seeing ourselves as undeserving will viciously cycle into the result of consistency, and the expectation reinforces our sense of worthlessness. The more our self-esteem drops, the less likely we are able to act, from which will well generate positive feedback to elevate our deteriorating self-worth. The key to reversing the process of self-doubt and lies is creating empowered interpretations about things and others say and do rather than negative interpretations, but berate us and fuel feelings to inadequacy. Become proficient in distinguishing facts from interpretations. We too often confuse what we actually said or done with the personal meaning we attribute to these occurrences. Those who suffer low self-esteem share a greater tendency to attack and tack negative meanings into life's events. The significance they place on these situations has negative personal connotations, even when we're intended or existed. These damaging interpretations immediately trigger action, sadness, or fear. These emotions rapidly become familiar and induce a false sense of security. Although we hate feeling angry, sad, or afraid, we continually create explanations for the events that land us in these moods. We continually collapse facts with interpretations. We continually collapse facts with interpretations. The stronger the emotions become, the greater our tendency to attribute incorrect connotations to situations. The more we do so, the further our self-esteem erodes. The good news is that anyone can learn a new behavior of attaching positive or neutral meaning from which is said or done, replacing a typical negative implication. The first step requires developing the ability to distinguish facts from interpretations we attribute to the facts. This is especially useful during the times of stress and upsetness, when the emotions of anger, sadness, and fear are present. Like red flags, these emotions warn us that we are confusing facts with interpretations, triggering the negative self-talk that eats away at our self-esteem. Let's examine the destructive self-talk in detail. Picture the negative self-talk as a cynical character that clings to your shoulder that we'll call Chip. It's important to distinguish Chip's disparaging voice entirely separate from the outside of yourself. Chip can be a male or female, from which we often take a persona and qualities of a disapproving parent or an early detractor. It's important to distinguish between Chip's pessimistic counsel and a wise guidance of your intuition and conscience. The former is skeptical and fear-based, whereas the latter reflects wisdom and inner insights. Your intuition is never wrong. It is the knowing inner light that guides you through your life's turbulent seas. In contrast, Chip may be a single-minded but a very valuable championing your excellence or making you feel good about yourself. His job is neither to keep you unimportant or protect you from the risk of all the treadmill forever trying to do better and become more worthy. He does his best by whispering the nonsense into your ear that causes you to feel bad about who you are. The result is two common scenarios. First is that you sell out your needs and your dreams, avoid new situations, and shrink away from new magnificence. Second is you have driven to achieve and prove Chip wrong about how unworthy you are, maybe to realize that you haven't been played on both sides of the scenario in different parts of your life. Let's examine the first situation. Chip likes it when you become a victim because it makes his job easier. Victims don't belong. People like them, and they don't look good. Victims also are outside of risk from their comfort zones or to aspire to any great or dangerous accomplishments. They live in the world marketed by resignation, a world that excludes them and not good enough to play. Chip can have a mistakenly belief that it is safer to hide out, quit trying to give up, than it is to reach for the stars and go for the gold. He has the believing of an actually better life. It's safe to avoid risk and circumvent failure. He is quick to point out that all the reasons why he should feel bad about who you are. He prefers that you believe his put down so that you will think of yourself worthy enough to try. You won't think of yourself worthy enough to try new ventures and find success or freedom. If you don't try, you can't fail. And so Chip will have protected you from the unpleasant possibility. You know by listening to his guidance that you will mangle the relationships and sabotage your success. He considers both unnecessarily risky and, like the unprotective master, prefers that you stay home and hide under your bed rather than you lead the hunt. He'd rather get angry with yourself and being a closer and instead of being a loser than the risk worse fate of overstepping your abilities. Chip is also the master of guilt. He reminds you of all the times you've messed up, selfishness, hurt others, and fell on your face. He causes you to beat yourself up repeatedly. By doing so is a contrary way of actually feeling better, knowing that you have been properly punished for your transgressions. Chip may tell you that life is not so bad if lived quietly without the stress of accompanies the need of accomplishing great things. Maybe you rationalize that you're not expecting all the bad extremes to playing small or beneath your potential, but perhaps that your life is dimmed, void of passion over the powerful from which you could possibly experience if you played a higher level, restoring a healthy sense of self-respect. Will support and reclaim your significance of generating a variety of new possibilities for happiness and accomplishment. Chip also can run your life in convincing you that you can overcome an unworthiness and only try harder to strive for perfection. He has only convinced you of your worthlessness, and your worthlessness can be managed or camouflaged if you climb to the top of the ladder that's leaning against the wall of flawlessness, with the end of the ladder obscured as the clouds above. Once you reach, you think at the top of the ladder, you discover that you're still not perfect, haven't accomplished nearly enough to encounter worthlessness, and you must continue to climb the ladder until you reach the faultless estate. And of course, the ladder never ends. Perfection is always disappointingly out of the reach of mistingly out of sight, from which you get continually beat yourself up in your life, is driven to achieve the unreachable objective. The more Chip betrays you under the good enough and harder to try worthy, which will equate you to being perfect, coming from the disempowerment state of self flagellation, you narrow Leslie to be in the best of achievement to your potential. Coming from this disempowered state of self-flagellation, you are likely to be your best and achieve to your potential. There is no peace in this setup. In either scenario, Chip succeeds in shattering your self-esteem and having a great resign yourself of never being good enough and messing with your ability to separate from what happened to you in your interpretations. Reclaiming your self-esteem will be the result from your ability to recognize when Chip is speaking his nonsense and realizing his misguided counsel does not support your excellence, happiness, or magnificence. Guilt is always optional. Instead of berating yourself for your faults, your excellence will result from being able to respond in the manner consistent with your visions, values, commitments, and life's purpose. Also, many of the derogatory messages that Chip whispers did not start with us. We didn't always program the disappearing phrases that misinterpret our words and actions, causing our self-esteem to suffer. Many times we were actually told that we were not good enough and unlovable, unworthy, the best things in life from which others, however, we did accept and absorb someone else's belittling delusions. Perhaps a parent, grandparent, or other person who told you that you were flawed in some way and you believe them. Chip now may take in the person's words to remind you that your inferiority, whether your derogatory thoughts originated from your own misinterpretations from an unkind words of others, you still have the ability to recognize that these thoughts are untrue and do not support your happiness. You possess the awesome power to stifle or critique every time he or she speaks those critical words. Chip will never go away as long as you live. He lives to create dissatisfaction regarding who you are and the core of what your life is about. The more upset, strife, and suffering he helps you create it, the worse you feel about yourself and the more Chip is validated. You will find Chip to be especially vocal during times of stress and upsetness. He uses the opportunities to remind you of how poorly you measured up. The best you could do is recognize the misguided intention and either protect your self from harm or motivate you to the better. Put your emotional earplugs on so that you can't hear the sabotaging messages, recognizing his voice when he shows up. He speaks in opinion and knows the need not to listen when he says his imprudent, distrustful advice that puts you down, ruins relationships, and promotes upsetness. The most effective way to temporarily silence Chip is to forcefully tell him to shut up and take a hike. You need to be forceful and silence with a cynical chatter. As he continues dishing it out, your ability to discern between Chip's dominant, disparaging voice and the softer, wise counsel of your own inner intuition will support your self-esteem to prosper. Exercise. For the next week, as you go about your day, notice each time Chip puts you down or makes you feel wrong, puts you into feeling of small. Record your negative thoughts that you have of yourself. Clearly differentiate Chip's voice from the voice of your trusted intuition. Note each cynical thought that serves your purpose of Chip's perspective. Perhaps makes the right of something, allows you to dominate others to protect you from a potential of harm or tear down or let down. Maybe it's been driven to succeed, has a berate of yourself for your guilt or your pity, or has you avoid seizing responsibilities for the magnificence. Half the battle of silencing Chip is to recognize when he is speaking to you and realize that his counsel is nonsense. Tell Chip off with a forceful way so you can tell him to hear. You don't need to hear his misguided voice. Replace his negative whispers with positive affirmations that stress your inherited self-worth and value as a magnificent human being. Dr. Joe Rubino, the life-changing success coach of internationally acclaimed business consultant, speaker, best-selling author of 8 books, 2 tape sets, CEO of the Center for Personal Reinvention, www.centerforpersonalreinvention.com. An organization committed to personal excellence and empowerment of all people. His vision is to personally impact the lives of 20 million people to their best and shift the paradigm around resignation. That is, if anyone can bring about positive change in their own lives and the lives of others, if they believe they can. The information on personal coaching and courses to request his free newsletters, to learn more about his books and audio programs, visit the website and contact him, or contact him at drjrubino@email.com. 3 secrets to manage your time. The secret to getting things done is time management. The secret to time management is to list your to-dos and then prioritize them. Do first things first. But here's the secret: you know, your mind can work with some sort of to-dos while you do other ones. In other words, make a list of things that you could do today. Work on the ones that you're most urgent while you allow yourself to unconscious mind to work on the other ones. For example, when I need to write something down, such as an article or a book chapter, I often ask my unconscious mind to work on it first. Seem ethereal, but the truth of psychology is turn over many cases possible to your unconsciousness. And even in the deeper secret of time management, the universe of all that is in this world will do some of the to-do list for you if you let it. When I make a to-do list, I have things in the right column and I plan to do, and things on the left column which I want the universe to do. For example, if I make a phone call, write articles, pay bills, run errands, however, I also make a request to the universe to help find the right buyer for a house, to bring me the right contact for my new project, and so forth. This is truly life's greatest missing secret. The universe will help you get things done if you let it. Naps are good. When your work seems bleak and you feel out of sorts, when your body's tired and your mind seems wild, sometimes all you need is a good nap. Letting go of your fears. Cindy Cashman. Sometimes fear can be paralyzing. Maybe it stopped you from asking someone new out on a date, or the other person has you feeling hindered from making a decision for going after a promotion. Whatever it is, it's important to realize that keeping a healthy perspective on what you want is the key thing when handling your fears. In order to help you create and maintain a clear perspective, to come up with three additional keys: ask, answer, action. Triple A, ask, answer, action. Ask. Let you say what you want to lose. You try to do all the diet pills, fast foods, low-fat foods. Still, you're overweight and discouraged. So now what? What is stopping you from losing the weight? Now you have to ask yourself. It requires total honesty with yourself, because you have to really get the comfort zone to gain personal and true perspective on what's blocking you. Here's an example of how powerful the question can be. When I was a single mom, I knew very little of money, and I asked myself, what is stopping me from getting what I want? And at the time, I wanted it was to make a lot of money, and the question completely changed my life for the better. In my mini power book, The Million Dollar Questions Handbook, I go into detail of asking quality questions. And if you ask questions such as, why does this always happen to me, or why are other people luckier than I am, then your life will answer the reflect of those answers, demonstrating more the lack of bad breaks and more misfortune. But you ask questions such as, what is stopping me from using my talents and abilities to create wealth and good health and joy? Then giving yourself opportunity to explore the blocks that are keeping you from experiencing the life that you want to live. Also ask yourself the question, what keeps me from going outside of my comfort zone, thus becoming more aware of stopping you that you can move past it. Answer. Once you've asked yourself the question, answer it honestly as you can. Really face yourself and search the answers, because you can change your life. Remember, it only takes one cause to keep you from losing weight, making a lot of money, or finding that special someone. Answer. Take action. Action actually consists of two steps: adopt and allow. In order to take the necessary action, you need to adopt a new perspective and allow yourself to receive the abundance. In order, if either part is left out, you are not likely to complete any necessary action. Action actually consists of two parts: adopt and allow. In order to take the necessary action, you need to adopt the new perspective. Adopt the new perspective and allow yourself to receive the abundance. Adopt. You see and believe, and deep down each know of you stopping us from exactly from what you want to have, and it's a good news. When you realize what this is, you can begin to change your perspective and adopt the new perspective, releasing the old one, thereby giving you the freedom to move forward into your new life. Allow. Now allow yourself to receive the abundance that it's yours. Yes, allow yourself, because at this point, you should understand that this is only you that is preventing you from achieving everything that you want to achieve. Personal story of overcoming fear. One day I finally had it. I was exhausted from a living day, and I just barely got it. I just barely was getting by. I was determined to find out a way to break through my financial challenges. The moment I decided that I was fed up with being temporarily out of money was the big changing point in my life. So I sat down and promised myself that I would do whatever it takes necessary to answer my question, what is stopping me from making lots of money? I took a piece of paper down and wrote down in two columns. The top of the first column I wrote, what is stopping me from becoming rich? And at the top second column I wrote, what do I need to do to overcome those fears? Ask, what is stopping me from becoming rich? What do I need to do to overcome those fears? Instantly, the answer came without hesitation, a pure knowing filled in my being. I knew exactly what was stopping me. The important thing was to understand is the time of asking the question as you mind your search for the answer. It's like a new engine on the internet. When you search for the engine, you type out certain keywords or phrases will bring you to a list of matching requests. Your mind works in the same way. Then you have to be careful from which kind of questions you ask. Ask a question that you will get a quality answer. The answer came to me as a certain friend. Answer came to me was that of a certain friend, we'll call him Bob, was keeping me from becoming financially rich for the intended period that he would call me, asking me if he could come live with me for a while and keep borrowing money from me. Being a simple mom without extra money, I lended him. I didn't want to feel responsible for his problems, but I also didn't want to feel guilty because I wasn't a good friend of not helping him out with his problems. While experiencing those feelings, I wondered about the problems that I might have if I were wealthy. Would I allow him to come and live with me? Would I have to help him out all the time? When I finally realized the reason I was sabotaging my success, not only did I not want to feel obligated to do anything that I did not want to do, I realized that I had to start being honest with myself. This was a huge turning point in my life, because I didn't know how much I realized what I was denying. I kept making excuses for the effects of the actions that weren't that bad. The kind of excuses that shut down the flow of answers of information you need to eliminate blocks of barriers. So the left-handed column read Bob, and the right-hand column became obvious to me. I needed to learn how to say no. So I did. I was able to realize that Bob was responsible for his own problems. Once I became totally fed up with the financial situation, asked for the better, I decided to let go of my denial. Then I was free to break free from my fears and succeed in a massive way. So here's what it looked like. Ask, answer, adopt, and allow. Ask, what is stopping me from making lots of money? Ask, what can I do to overcome it? Answer was Bob. Answer, tell him no. Adopt, I'm not responsible for his problems. Allow myself to move forward and have success. You will come to realize that this is the source of all your conditions and situations in life. I thought Bob was stopping me from becoming rich, but what I learned that I had to learn from handling potential problems up front, that no one would have that kind of power over me. This is a very powerful process that helped free me. Now it's your turn. Take another sheet of paper and begin the process changing and creating your new perception. Here are some of the questions that help you get started. What is stopping me from losing weight, getting financially rich, having a great relationship, starting my own business, having a career I want, moving forward with my dreams, believing in myself? Next, asking yourself, what do I need to overcome it? Let the answer come, adopt your new perspective, and allow yourself to achieve and succeed. The above information is from the Cindy Cashman as a part of her www.creatingbuildingwealth.com program. How to break through hidden obstacles holding you back from what you truly want. Craig Perrin. What do you want right now in your life that you don't have? More love, more money, success, adoration, better health? I have a simple exercise that would help you reveal the hidden obstacles that is holding you back. Ready? Get a piece of paper. Take a minute to write down the specific thing that you really want. Then, write down everything that comes to mind that is standing in your way of getting that one thing that you want. It's really important that you get a perfectly clear from what you need to break through and what you're going to want. And it'll make you at least have a few minutes to do this before reading on. Done. Done? Okay. Now, what's on your list? Is your job lousy? Do you live in the wrong part of town? Do you know the right people? Do you have any capital to start building your business you dreamed of? Do you have enough time to learn the new skill to take on a new project? At one, I was plagued by those handling handicaps and more. Perhaps you're faced with the same obstacle, in fact, a commonly accepted for those who hold most everybody from succeeding that one point or another. Now, complete the exercise by writing, none of these things is truly keeping me from getting what I want. See? After the years of studying some of the very wise manners of reading countless books, I've learned the secret of helping me overcome those challenges and many, many others too, is, if you think about it, just about everything that you've ever truly wanted has required you to overcome some obstacle to get it. So you can imagine how powerful it is to discover the secret to being able to break through any obstacle you attain you desires. Here's a secret that other wise men have shared with me, and I admit it, that it took me years to actually accept it. The only thing holding you back from getting whatever you desire is yourself. All those things that you wrote down as far as on your way and symptoms of a true obstacle, that you believe those things can block you or hold you back, what you believe is directly related from what you've soaked up automatically from people or events around you from a day-to-day from when you were born. The sad truth is that most of these things pumped into your head is the opposite of what you lead of a happy living life, and in fact, is probably 99% of the reason you don't have what you want today. You will find that your true self is hidden, buried beneath layers and beliefs in which you've collected from others, ever really challenging them. The true self is a very powerful being, capable of attracting whatever you desire, often quickly and easily out of the struggle from which you may have accepted as being required to achieving anything. As we grow, we are taught more to mature and leaving behind our fantasies and believing of the magic around us in the world. We worship science and facts from which we want to see as reality view of the world because that's what everyone else believes. However, there's real magic in the world, and there are books like Dr. Joe Vitale's best-selling author, Attractor Factor, that can show you how to tap into what draws you the desires of your life. When I first heard I was responsible for everything in my life, I initially accepted and began to beat up on myself for every failure and setback. What was harder for me to take credit for the powerful results I've created, accept that I could manifest and I wanted at any level to imaginable. I wanted at any level imaginable. Over the years, I've learned that being responsible for everything in your life isn't about blame or even boasting about your success, but simply acknowledging that connection between you and your do and your don'ts from how it yields the results that you get. Although you may first be intimidated by the feel of reluctance to remove a shield of blaming others and events and beyond your control, the truth is to take full responsibility is the fastest, most powerful way to change what you don't like and add what you do want in your life. After all, if something bad happens and you don't do it, you can truly fix it. Can you truly fix it? That's okay to the reality. You can take your charge and focus your energy on what it'll take to get the results that you want to learn to avoid that won't. Imagine how difficult it would be to learn how to ride a bike if you blamed every spill on the pavement, on the bike, on obstacles that got in your way, instead of practicing how to balance, how to street, when to use your brakes, how to learn to ride a bike. As they say, you never forget how to ride a bike, and once you have a bike, you've learned. Well, it's the same thing with taking charge of your life and breaking through the obstacles. Once you fully understand how to create your reality, you suddenly have an ability to plot a course to your desires that will truly amaze you because it feels like magic. If you want to see a movie that is a wonderful metaphor for the principle, watch The Matrix. There's a scene from which the main character, Neo, realizes that he has the power to do anything. And in fact, he does, and he has everyone else formally believing in his impossibleness. And believing to be impossible. I won't spoil the movie if you haven't seen it already, but you'll know the moment when you see it. Whenever I feel overwhelmed and I forget that I know about creating my own reality, I visualize Neo discovering his true unlimited power. And I remember that I'm writing this book. And I'm writing this because often in my life I hear success principles like these, that you are what you believe. And if you say that you can, you can. If you say you can't, you can't. But we become numb the full meaning these principles hold for us. It's too easy to let conventional wisdom pack our minds full of comforting nonsense that popular cultures feed us and overlook the richer and infinite, more powerful truth that we all find limited in our self-imposed boundaries. It is our responsibility to believe what brings us what we want. Movies like What the Bleep will open your eyes to exactly from which to truly of your driver's seat of your life. The movie like What the Bleep will open your eyes to exactly how you truly are in the driver's seat of your life. So, just a learning to the ride of bikes seems confusing and even painful at first. Once you realize that you're doing the steering, you'll be able to finally propel yourself in the direction you want to go in life and ride around any obstacle that appears on your journey. Craig Perrine is the internet marketing expert and mentor. See www.easymiracles.com. Who you see is who you will be. Kevin Hogan. If there were 7 things that I would tell my kids to do to be truly successful and achieve in their lives, one of them would be to select the people that they spend time with carefully. Scientific research clearly reveals that parenting and genetics are important, but they do not hold a candle in influencing behavior and the results from which people in the environment do. Let me state, this is no uncertain terms. If you hang out with losers, you will gravitate towards losing. If you hang out with winners, the same is true. The reason that this is the case is simple. We all do things to cooperate and compete with people in our environment. This is to be the culture of society, and one of the levels that you can be in your own peer group is in neighbors and to others. Defining a winner or a loser can be different or difficult. Not everyone can care about getting to the achievement orientation as you are. Achieving is a behavior, and the results from which it happens from you do specific things that other achievers do. For me, winners don't have to be wealthy, but they certainly can be. And it's only one attribute that reveals self-discipline. Another attribute is to look forward into others, and that is of kindness. It is the quality, I don't bend much. I don't hang out with unkind people. Unkindness is like a disease. Nice is worth a lot of short-term and long-term, but it's the only way to be. People who get things done are a must of my environment. People who get things done. I'm not interested in seeing someone start lots of projects. I'm interested in seeing someone finish lots of projects. This too is contagious. People who are seeing their work through the completion of the exhibiting self-discipline is the discipline that most people do not have. I will bend this characteristic, but know how much time I can to be invest into people who don't finish projects. Not much. Because there are no perfect people, and this is to appear perfect in a plenty of skeletons, I promise you. Because there are no perfect people, and those that appear perfect have plenty of skeletons, I promise you. You want to choose people who are making the attempt. Do not pay attention to people who are talking success. Talk is cheap, and all positive thinking of the planet doesn't get you the results. If you have positive thinking isn't getting results, it's creating a big problem for you. And if you're around the positive talker, you have no better benefit from being around the negative thinker, as at least the pessimist is finding the problems that need to be solved. Meanwhile, if the positive person is changing lives and achieving his or her dreams, then you have found someone who to put your mastermind or support team alliance. Who else do you want to surround yourself with? You want to surround yourself with who? People with a true psychic. Someone who sees problems coming in solution in advance of the arrival, is ready to implement them when ready to arrive so you can move on. This person is one of the most valuable people that you can have on your team. Developing these characteristics will help you go far as well. Finally, you want to choose someone who communicates in real terms. There is no lottery to be won. God is not a slot machine. Almost everything you ultimately achieve in life is not going to happen because of happening. It's because you caused it to happen. Yes, you can get an inheritance. I never did, by the way. You could be raised in the middle of an upper income family. I was raised in a family of a low decile of income. You have to be given a big job by a big company because mom and dad knew the right person. But over time, the legacy of your work and your passion is what gets you where you are going. You can't stop the World Trade Center from falling with your prayer, nor can you pray the dying person back to health. But you can cause wonderful events after event to take place in your life and in your lives of those around you if you don't create your entire reality. You don't create your entire reality, but you do shape everything from what you see in front of you. You create your kids, your neighborhood's kids, going from the most of the good things and bad traits, though. Most people create their bank accounts, and those who have had bad things happen in life can be in the process of creating a new bank account. Every day, that is, what was first a thought. Buddha said that, not me. Every day, that is, was first a thought. Everything, that is, was first a thought. Everything that is was first a thought, Buddha said, not me. I use that as a law of truth of my life. Like Edison and Ford, when I think of something and cause of it happen, I created the belief that for my abilities to do regularly by making sure that my thoughts become reality as often as they need to do so. Don't hang out with the dreamers. Hang out with the doers. Do you do as you believe in God? And do you believe in God? Let's say you do. In the beginning, God dreamed about making heavens and earth, but so got busy and never got around to do it. Do you want to hang out with the guy or this guy? In the beginning, God created the heavens and earth and saw it was good. That's my kind of guy. I'm not saying God is there. That's from you to decide. But I do know that you want to be in the presence of people who do. People who do have. They are the cause. They are the people that will have and help you shape your destiny. Choose well. It makes all the difference in the world. Kevin Hogan is the author of several best-selling books, including The Psychology of Persuasion. To everything, turn, turn, turn. Alan R. Bechtold. I grew up in the 60s, and I used to love the wonderful Peter Seeger song, Turn, Turn, Turn. To everything, there is a season, as it was recorded by the rock group The Birds. However, I'm constantly amazed about how many years has passed before the true meaning of the song actually sank in. It's such an important message. I wish I'd seen it earlier. Sadly, only the passing of my years made the meaning crystal clear until I finally saw it. I was a victim of life, pulled along in the circumstances, doomed to live in a path that lay before me, however twisted or riddled up with the sharp stones it might have been. When something bad happened, if my car broke down, or I lost a job, or even threw a party that didn't pan out, I would feel that life had it in for me, and there was no little that I could do to change or put a path on, or change the path I was on. Now, I fully understand the significance of Seeger's message. I've been liberated. I now enjoy everything that happens to me, good and bad. I constantly gain experience and knowledge from the wisdom from which all life experiences. Here's this message, woven not to subtle with Seeger's brilliant, beautiful lyrics, a message that is too often remains elusive until you live sufficient years to discover the real meaning. Everything happens for a reason. There's a plan, much bigger than any of us can see, and everything in life delivers us to fit its plan, and the part of the parcel overall, the big picture, will forever remain outside our grasp. Nothing happens accidentally. Everything that happens is somehow intricately connected to a much larger picture. Knowing this, seeing this, making all of life's experiences tragic or ecstatic, take on the entire new meaning. It also changes your approach when you face with life's challenges. Knowing the true meaning of those lyrics, understanding the underlying message, I know, head into each and every day charged up with fully ready for any challenge, big or small, because I know that my heart, even the most monumental of setbacks, are part of a script, a storyline. The inevitable leads to learning, wisdom, and advancement in life. The most tragic of events are then merely stepping stones of greater things. Test you, must you are. And must you not only endure the turns into the benefit from which you are now to grow and fit into the unseen plan that is spread out before all of us? You can't fight the plan, but you can fit yourself into it by learning from your mistakes, taking whatever lessons you can find from everything good or bad that happens in your life. And believe me, there are plenty of lessons to be learned, so it's not just the willy-nilly happenstance after all. Everything is an experience that holds the key somehow, some way, to a greater understanding of your place and plan, of the ability to fit into that plan and make it work for you to have a better and better your life. You are not the mercy of your life. You are not at the mercy of your life. You are at the mercy of your own willingness to accept life. All of it. Learn everything that you can from all that life has to offer you. You've heard the saying that without bad, there will be no good. Without bad experiences, you cannot appreciate the good experiences that happen. And here's the most vital key. How you handle the bad things that happen, from which you weigh, from which you deal, and how do you learn from them, actually enhances your increasing the numbers of durations from which good things that also can happen. I don't claim to understand an overall grand plan. No one can. It's forever beyond our grasp, as it should be. However, we can understand the tiny pieces of the puzzle that we are dealt to make an effort to fit those pieces into a larger puzzle so that we fit into the plan and benefit from the enormous bounty of treasures it has to offer us when we do our parts and the pieces of the puzzle fit. Bucking the plan, failing to understand life's lessons and joys is what makes us a victim of life, flowing with the plan, learning from the hard experiences life has to offer, growing as a result, making you fit in, brings you into a fold and makes your life start working for you in ways that you could never have imagined. When I first started publishing online in 1984, there was these things called computer bulletin boards. I was convinced they were the wave of the future, and I built my entire business around them. It turned out to be only partially right. Online communications was the wave of the future. I failed to see the computer bulletin boards were not the wave future was destined to be realized. They were instead merely a stepping stone for the next phase of the development for the industry and for me. I failed to see that until my business nearly failed as I buckled to change the World Wide Web. Finally, 1996, faced the more than $40,000 in personal debt in a company from when it was tanking quickly, I saw the lighter, and I learned my lesson. I saw the light, and I learned my lesson. Only then did I decide to go into the flows rather than to fight it, stopping bucking the change, and I found a way to make my company fit into the change. The result is I switched gears completely, embraced the web, and applied the knowledge of online marketing and publishing the new phase of online communications. Over the next 5 years, generated more than $12 million in sales. This is a direct result. None of this would have happened if it had not been for my first experience with the early dial-up computer bulletin boards. It was experience there to lead me to being a partner, which made it possible. When I finally switched gears and entered a World Wide Web to make all those sales, I would never have met him. Had been for my earlier failure, that failure that led me to unmanageable success, to unimaginable success. If you realized what I realized too late, you'd be ahead of the game. Life is a starting game. Never fear failure. And even failure holds you the keys to your next success. Don't hold back because you're afraid from which making a mistake. Even big mistakes, when you are studied, are the lessons learned to properly applied, provide bridges to accomplishments down the road. Don't forget, even a failure is an instant bridge towards bridges to accomplishments down the road. Don't forget also to study your successes. Don't ever take success for granted. I experienced a great deal of success with the computer bulletin boards earlier on. Sometimes early success is only set up for the failure from which you learn from later to truly succeed. Within any success, there is clues that can help you repeat the success and build upon it. And there are keys to overcoming the failures. There are sure ways of coming later. Learn this now. See if for what it is. Realize that you have control only over a tiny piece of the overall puzzle. Realize it. That will fit your tiny piece into the overall plan. That is there for your good for all. Then you will find peace and satisfaction in all your life has to offer. Alan Bechtold operates the BBS Press Service. See www.sysop.com. Ultimately, there are only two answers to every question. Positive or negative. It's your decision which one to choose. Naressa Odin, www.thevideoqueen.com. What I wish I'd learned when I was younger. Bob Shenfield. When I was 12 years old, my grandfather started me on the road, understanding that there was visible and invisible forces shaping what happened to us every day, and the visible forces are what real power is. The revolutionary information my grandfather shared with me took me to many places in my pursuit of knowledge, of inspiration, tradition, science, historic teachings, metaphysics, new age thought, quantum physics, and so forth. As I studied and worked, three core questions surfaced that I felt compelled to answer. Who am I? Why am I here? What is my purpose? Three core questions I was compelled to answer. I had no problem answering question number one. To me, we're all amazing beings whose natural state of infinite power, wisdom, and abundance, that is great, from we're all godlike at our score and godlike at our core. I had no problem answering the question number two either. To me, we all come from a human experience to play of our adventures, and just as we go into the movies and amusement parks, I have no problem answering question number three. To me, our purpose is simply to explore from the questions and experiences we can have as we're here. And I probed more deeply into life's mysteries. However, especially after having some mind-blowing experience of studying recent developments in quantum physics, another core question came to mind. Is the human being experience and all we see around us real? When I say real, I mean, is it solid and tangible? I mean, does it have an existence independent of us? Does it have any real power in hand of itself? Such questions seem unnecessarily theoretical, but the answers actually have tremendous practical value in our lives. What I concluded, my esoteric teacher suggested, the recent developments in the quantum physics document put the number fleshes out in the practical way from which I had learned when I was younger, is this human experience, the whole physical universe we all play, is not real. It is all an illusion, a hologram from which we call a total immersion movie experience created by a combination of consciousness, tremendous power, from which it makes it appear real. Life is just a game being played in consciousness, and it's our power, the infinite, as infinite beings we are, that fuels it. What I wish I knew when I was earlier was that, if you can really understand that, making several important shifts in your own consciousness can help you tap into sources of unimaginable power to redesign your shape, literally, everything you experience in your life. It's kind of like having what is called a lucid dream, from which you wake up in the middle of a dream and take total control over everything happening within it. I would have loved to have awakened within my human experience a lot earlier than I did. Bob Shenfield, the best-selling author, The Visible Path to Success, The 11th Element. For more than 20 years, he has helped individuals in more than 170 countries create extraordinary results in less than time, less effort, and more in fun. The more information, visit www.7powercentersoul.com. soflife.com, soflife.com. The great philosophers were only given their own views. The great philosophers were only giving you their views. All the great philosophers and psychologists you ever heard of are giving you their opinion. They have to map of which they think of the world works. This is a map of the philosophy or psychology. It isn't necessarily true. It's their opinion. You can create your own view of the world. You could choose your own existing philosophy or psychology and make one up. Few people know that we all have that choice. External connections. Caring for others in your life. Here it is. Remember, the most valuable life lesson you'll ever learn, Chip Tarver. Here it is. Remember, the use of this one. If you use this, forget everything else you've ever learned if you've been taught. But you must use this one. The golden rule. Treat others as you want to be treated, or treat them as you want to be treated. That's $1 million primary principle. Literally, there are no other precedents around you from which you fashion your life than this guiding primary principle. When you put yourself aside and consider others first, people not only remember you, but they want to be around you. Why? Using the principle means that you're a great listener. Too many people are just too interested in what they have to say, or have quite enough, long enough from what they hear, what they have to say. Too many people out here are too concerned with their own needs and wants, and they don't take time to consider yours. We see these important issues affecting marriages and jobs every day. When you separate yourself from the pack of them, putting others simply first, you begin a great as an active listener, and then you respond with the primary idea of creating a win-win situation for everyone involved, and you're a winner. Take that to the bank, literally. When you separate yourself from the pack and putting other people first, being a great and active listener, and then respond with the primary idea of creating a win-win situation for everyone involved, you're a winner. Take that to the bank, literally. When you try to help other people get what they want, the law of reciprocation says that they'll help you and help you get what you want. And that's good. It's not being selfish. It's simply being wise. You just set into a motion of spiritual law from which no one can stop. This is a primary principle in life from which only the blessed of all people around you is also directly translated into great relationships and more deposits ticket into your bank. So never forget, always give first, and always be sure to employ the most important life principle, the golden rule, today, every day, as a system that's proven to work every single time. So treat people the way you want to be treated. Your relationships are for your growth. Don't expect any long-term relationships to be smooth sailing. The bumps and hills and valleys and rises, falls all the time of life, and that's what helps you grow. If you give up and blow out, you may miss a great lesson, and you'll end up in another relationship that'll give you the lesson that you use more dramatic in a more dramatic way. The point is to stay together and to grow, not separate and sulk. You may come to a moment when you both calmly and respectfully decide to move down different paths, but jumping out of a moving car isn't wise or healthy. Staying in your seat and enjoy the ride. Practice forgiveness, tolerance, and compassion. This won't always be easy, but it will always be for your growth. Your parents did the best that they could. I never liked how my father raised me. He was my ex-Marine drill sergeant, former professional boxer. He treated me like a drafted recruit from the World War II and World War I. He grew up resenting the beatings and the discipline and the constant terror. A friend of mine in college shocked me when he said, "Your father could have tossed you in the garbage, when you were a baby. He didn't. He raised you the best way that he knew how. And since then, that's all the parents are winging it. And since then, learning that, all parents are winging it. None of them went to the parenthood. Few of them read parenting books. Most of them raised their kids either the way they were raised on the opposite side from which the way they were raised. None of them raised their kids with ill intent. They were doing the best that they could. Your parents did the best that they could and what they know how to do, based on their beliefs, upbringing, and the best guess from which they know how to handle you. Forgive them. Understand them. Love them. All they want from you at this point is to know that you understand that they did the best they could. Let them so. Don't withhold the very thing as long to hear. Don't withhold the very thing that they long to hear. Your children will become what they become. How can you tell what your child will grow up to be? Next Dalai Lama? You can't. My sister has twins. They were raised in the same environment, in the same parents, same teacher, same school, same, and they dated sisters. In spite, they had a completely different personality, goals. Water your children with love and allow them to grow as they choose, and to be sure to give them each a copy of this manual. You can achieve anything with support. You can find that getting results in your life is easier when you have people supporting you. I'm not talking about financial support. though you may think that that would be nice. Instead, I'm talking about emotional support. Whether you want to lose weight, quit smoking, increase your income, build a business, raise a family, most like anything else, having support teams will have you make a process much easier for you. Most people in their life will have you achieve the things that they want of their own. Ultimately, whatever you achieve will be because of your own efforts. We're having others to encourage us makes it easier for us to make the efforts needed for the success. It's the difference between running a marathon alone and running one alone with a crowd to cheer you on. This works on the other way around too. Helping others by encouraging them will help you. You will feel satisfaction from their wins, and it'll increase your own energy as you offer some of yours to others. In short, by willing to ask for or offer help to achieve your dreams. Listening, John Milton Frog. Listening, in the beginning it is written, was the word. Problem is, nobody was listening. Besides the universal life purpose of I believe in human beings share the learning to love and be loved, listening is the life lesson which I had learned and learned long ago. In the beginning, listen. My mentor, Carol McCall, said, and so titled her book, there's a world waiting to be heard. All you need to do is read a magazine, newspaper, blog, or perish the act. Turn on the television, learn how people are. Communities, corporations, countries are not listening. Look at it. Look how everyone is. There's no one listening, and the tragic prices they're all paying for not listening. Even though 85% of what we know now is learned by listening, researchers found that we are distracted, preoccupied, and forgetful of 3/4 of our time. Or we hear what people say, but we're not really listening. Not really? Proof. Proof? More research. We only remember 20% of what we hear. Why? Because although we listen to between 125 to 250 words per minute, we think about 1,000 to 3,000 words per minute. And while other people are speaking, we're thinking, thinking, thinking. Here's the William J. Striggle Fellow wrote in a Quaker Monthly Friends Journal. Listening is a rare happening among human beings. You cannot listen to a word another is speaking if you are preoccupied with your appearance, if you're impressing others, or with impressing the other, or if you're trying to decide what you're going to say when the other person stops talking, or debating about whether what's being said is true or relevant or agreeable. Such matters have place, but only after listening to the word as the word is being uttered. Listening is a primitive act of love. It is which a person gives himself to another word, making himself accessible and vulnerable to that word. Simple science shows us to two things that can take up the same space at the same time, so it is with listening. You cannot think and listen, read and listen, daydream and listen, write and listen, agree and argue and listen, interpret, mind read, rehearse, plot, plan, prolocate, or even listen and listen. Apologies to the multitasker gender, or apologies. Listening requires full, focused attention on the other person. Real listening truly honors people. Authentic listening can actually heal people. One bit I appreciate most from most of the quote of the Stringfellow, listening is a primitive act of love. What makes it special as an important for me is it takes it right back to the beginning. If I said that, and I believe every human being shares the same life purpose to learn, to love, to be loved, then listening gives me a simple, though not easy to master, but truly elegant power tool to fulfill my life's purpose. Yet the number of us use have formal education experiences in listening is less. 2 in every 100 people. I wished I'd learned to listen long, long ago. John Milton Frog, author of The Greatest Networker in the World. What you do influences people down the chain. Few people stop to think about the fact of how they treat people and part of a chain that influences all the people. On the level that is simplest to understand, when a smile of someone on the street or people may be uplifted to such a degree that they smile to the next person that they see, they smile to the next person they see, and so on down the chain. The single act can uplift a lot of people. By the same token, when you get angry, give a person a dirty look. The person has received from your negativity may pass it on to the next person they see, who pass it on to the next person they see, and so on and so on. It becomes a mind virus. Control the virus. Send out positive signals to influence the world chain. It all begins with you. People like nice people. I met a few celebrities when I told them at my seminars, from which was private about them and of the principles and private about them. I always wanted to know one thing. Are they nice? What we all like? We all like people who are nice, meaning pleasant, smiling, approachable, friendly. This is a clue about how to live your life. Be nice. People want to be loved. When my father was building a house for his family, the electrician he had hired became his best friend. They ate together, made wine together, drank together, laughed at old told stories. My father listened to anything his new friend told him because my father wanted to wanted the feeling of being loved. He also wanted the sound of a house, of course, from which was going to hire an electrician he trusted, which, of course, was an electrician who showed most love for my dad. Neither man from which they've ever felt for the other for each other. Deep down, they just have every one for one of us. They just have every one of us. What they longed for was love. Help people feel love, and they will pay you in gold. Having a role model can bring you out of the best. Having a role model can bring out the best in you. To bring out the best in you. Most people imitate the people around them. Families, friends, teachers, characters, televisions from movies, characters from movies. The problem is there's limits in which these roles bring out of you. If you truly want to strive for the best, then you can't emulate this. This may mean following the lead of a family, friends, or celebrities. It may also mean looking elsewhere. For example, when I got into bodybuilding, I wanted to follow the best. Although there were several famous people to choose from, I selected Steve Reeves from its original Hercules in the movies. Although I never looked exactly like Reeves, by modeling myself after him, I was able to transform my body from fat to fit. Others have copied Roy Rogers, having singing cowboys, find others heroics in themselves. This point is throughout the life itself. And to find people who will disappoint you. The idea is to find someone who has the traits you want to develop and model yourself after those traits. You don't want to become the person you are imitating. Instead, you want to develop the strengths that you have within yourself. Of course, if Superman is your role model, be sure to stay away from kryptonite. How to end an argument? Be the first to say, I'm sorry. As soon as you say it, the other side will look at you and see you as insincere. If you are, the tension will release. Be the first to say, I'm sorry. How to deal with an enemy? Ask them for their advice. Few people can resist asking for advice. You position yourself as an open-minded and your enemy will open up to you. Ask your enemy for their advice. The man who offered to beat me up. The man who offered to beat me up. Today I received a long letter from a man who created a new self-defense system. He claims that he can defeat anyone under 3 minutes. He wants me to promote him and his method. He went to say that he'd be happy to meet me and prove his skills. What did he have in mind? He wants to beat me up. I'm serious. If I can defeat you within 3 minutes, he said in his letter, then you promised to promote me and my products. Deal? He went on to give me the contact information for his agent so I could set up the match. It might have made an interesting webcast just to see the headline. 51-year-old formerly obese internet marketing expert meets a 30-year-old Superman fit martial artist in a quick kill match. Register now. Gee, I wonder who will win. I'd lose every time if I weren't armed. But what would I have done? How would I have responded to this offer? Unless your fighter looks for a match, you'd probably toss this offer in the trash. I often wonder what people are thinking. Does this guy really think I'll fight him and then lose? I'm gladly smile and start marketing him. I don't claim to be a fighter, and I'm not seeking bouts. I'm also not seeking new clients, especially one who wants to break my nose to prove that he's better than me. When you reach out to anyone, keep in mind that no one likes to be told that they are inferior. It's not a good way to win friends and influence people. In fact, not a good way to do much of anything. I think the lesson here is that we all have egos. The better way to approach people is to put your ego under theirs. In other words, be willing to lower your status. Don't flaunt your stuff. Instead, show your weakness and ask for help. This nerver fighter might have done better for offering to teach his new method, not offering to embarrass me with it. Take heed. Everyone is going through something. You may think that you're the only person suffering from money worries, health issues, relationships, problems, or just you name it. The truth is everyone is going through something. Knowing this can help you make more understanding, be more understanding to others. The person who just cut you off on the freeway may just have lost his job or had a child did something wrong and he may be sick. Just as you have had bad days, the events in which you can wrestle with and learn to grow, so do you with others. Just as you have bad days, the events that help you wrestle to help you learn and grow. So just remember that just as you want them to understand your life, you need to understand theirs. Mutual understanding can bring peace to the world. Failing life, Bill Harris. I flunked life lessons 101 several times before I figured out why. The area I flunked most often was romantic relationships. I'm the spitting image of my father and the man of his neurisms. My mother, who ultimately came to dislike my father, who divorced him when I was 3 years old, spent an adolescence telling me, "You're just like your father. No woman will ever put up with you." Because such deeply I've held the belief to manifest themselves a reality. Something I did not know at the time. I was continually acting and attracting to women from whom seemed to be a custom designed to help me prove the truth from which my mother had told me. The drama would play into its own two ways. I would either attract a woman who, because of her own problems, could not nurture a man who had a lot of trouble being intimate and had a lot of anger towards men, or I somehow accidentally attracted a woman who was emotionally healthy and I would find a way to drive her away with my own emotional problems. I replayed this scenario at least 20 times during my adult life. I met and fell over and for occasionally with the same woman, but every time a different body. With minor variations, the story had the same plot line, the same tragic ending every time. Same tragic ending every time. Eventually, in my attempt to clear up all this and my emotional problems, I learned to meditate. Later, I began to meditate very powerful on a Holosync audio technology from which offered through you my company, Centerpoint Research Institute. As I meditate each day over several years, I began to develop a deeper awareness of what I was doing and how I was creating these relationship disasters. I began to see in the entire process in a slow motion from the first blush attraction to the dance of courtship an emergency from which interlocking emotions, dysfunctional behaviors of me and my partners to eventually a criminally unhappy parting. As well, increasingly able to stand aside from which was happening and watch it from new awarenesses. Two things happened. First, I became more and more difficult to summon up my formerly boundless enthusiasms for the whole exercise, somehow standing aside and watching the process form more aware perspectives, knowing to advance and how to do it and what it turned out and how it would turn out, made it increasingly difficult to continue. Second, I realized that feeling the intense attraction that I'd always assumed meant here's a candidate to pursue for a romantic relationship did not mean that at all. Instead, I actually meant here's someone who would help you prove that your mother was right and no woman be able to put up with you. Seeing this was a new way for my soul-searing experience. As a result, I found myself not responding in the same way as I was feeling attraction. Instead, I was able to watch myself and have the feeling and knowing the advance from which would lead up what happened and leave it alone. Ironically, with a very short period of time, my ability to watch this feeling rather than to act on it led me to attract a totally different kind of woman. One who is warm, loving, and nurturing. One who is not there to play out the same script. Today I'm happily married and wonderful woman who deeply loves me. There were several lessons in this for me, of which I really had, and I had to learn them over 30 years. I wish I'd learned them over 30 years sooner. The first was that we believe what we believe does not create the circumstances and realities of our lives. It wasn't true that no woman would ever put up with me, but strongly believed that it was. I did create it in a reality. I have been able to use this wisdom to clear up my many other areas of my life, and they were not working as well as I wanted. Second, I learned that when any belief is made conscious, you are able to watch and create creative process and set emotion by the belief. From the first impulse to the end result, such beliefs dissolve and they do not serve you. You can continue to create the same negative consequences for decades if you do not unconsciously, but once you begin to do so with awareness, what does not serve you falls away as if it was by magic. Third, people have much more control over what they create in their life from which first they believe. In many years, I've continued to create painful relationships, feeling like a victim of circumstances, bad people, and other external events. When I learned, however, that what was happening to me was my own doing through unintentional, that it was inevitable results from which I was doing inside of my own head, I found that I had all the power and the control I needed to shape my life in any way that I wanted. As a great Napoleon Hill author of Think and Grow Rich, he said, "The one and only thing over which each person has total complete control is how they focus their mind. Luckily, this seemingly small ability is the key to everything else, and I feel grateful that I finally learned this." Bill Harris, the CEO of www.centerpoint.com. Troubleshooting, taking care of yourself. The universe always says yes. The universe, the energy of all that is in your life will always say yes to your thoughts. If you think negative thoughts, the universe will also say, okay, I agree with you, and bring you negative results. If you think positive thoughts, the universe will say, okay, I agree with you, and bring you positive results. In every situation, the universe will say yes. Once you get the lesson, you don't need the experience. Once you get the lessons of any experiences, you don't need to repeat the experience. Until you get the lesson, you will continue to recreate the experience, escalating in pain until you get the lesson. In other words, notice what people seem to have having the same problem. One person may get married 7 times. One person may also struggle with money. Another person may have the same health issue reoccur. None of these are predestined, or set in stone. Get the lesson and the experience is offered you, and the experience will leave. Pay attention to your lessons. Give what you want to receive. Everyone will talk to you out of this principle, but the truth remains. Give more of whatever you want to receive. If you want money, give money. If you want love, give love. The trick is to give without expecting return from any particular source. Allow the return to surprise you. Give with a joyous, expectant heart, but with an open mind too. You get the results you're supposed to get. You get the results you're supposed to get. It may be hard to accept, but the results you're getting here right now are from the results you're supposed to be getting. In other words, whatever you're doing right now is bringing you the results from what you're getting right now. If you are overweight, you probably did something to get those ways and to get that way. Get dropped off at a desert or a prison camp and you'll probably get thin. If you're alone, you're probably because you did or some things you were doing from which people at bay to help people at bay. Join enough on the internet sites to go into enough parties and meetings and you'll meet people. If you're broke, you probably were spending more than you need to at this point, not doing all that you need in order to bring in the money. When you look at your life objectively, you can see the results you are getting are exactly the results from which you should be expecting. Change what you are doing and you will change the results. Pretty simple, really. This too will pass. This too will pass. Whatever you are expecting right now, good or bad, painful or pleasurable, will pass. I like the movie External Sunshines of the Spotless Mind because it suggested, at least to me, that we are always running from the moment, rather than enjoying what is, whatever it may be. We are doing our best to escape to the future or to the past. When you realize that this, whatever this moment is for you, will pass, it may help you appreciate this moment. If you like this moment, dwell on it because it will soon be gone. If you don't like this moment, relax, as it will soon be gone. Be not afraid. Be not afraid. One of the recurring statements of the most philosophers of religions is that life is not scary. You will find yourself wanting to stop because of fear. You may want to ask for a date or a raise or a loan, or the fear will often stop you. The fear. The big secret is that there is nothing to fear. You will be hard to accept. It'll be hard to accept because of your mind, which will tell you, terrifying you with the scenarios to make you afraid. But again, be not afraid. Do the thing you wish and walk through the fear. On the other side is freedom. Be not afraid. Do what you wish. Walk through the fear. And on the other side of it is freedom. What you fear may contain what you seek. What you fear may contain what you seek. You may find the very thing that you seek is hidden with everything that you fear. For years, I was afraid of revealing my spiritual side to the world. I was an author of numerous books in conservative companies and also American Marketing Association, the American Managing Association, the Nightingale Connett. I did not want the world to know that I was softer, loving side. I was feared that they would judge me. When I finally released my books such as The Attractor Factor, largely because I was nudged by my friends to share them, the response was overwhelming. The book became an Amazon and Barnes & Noble bestseller. None of my books has ever been anywhere near as successful as that one. You may find that the thing that you fear, sharing with the world, may be the very, very thing from which the world thirsts for. When you share your fear, you may find it rewards you within what you seek. Be willing to delay gratification to achieve astonishing results. Be willing to delay gratification to achieve astonishing results. You may find most people will give you in their whims and urges from which much thought to tomorrow. You'll also find that we'll feel stronger, happier, we'll achieve greater results if you delay gratification in favor of long-term larger rewards. For example, the best way to lose weight is to ignore the impulse for unhealthy food and instead focus on the end result, a lean body, a longer life. I found it easier to ignore desserts and food temperament and temptations by realizing that consuming it now will give momentary pleasure, something that may not last 1 minute, and I'll regret it for weeks, months, or even years. Instead, if I ignore the impulse and focus on the long-term gain, the decision is easier to make. The lesson that takes a lot of speed bumps out of life. The lesson that takes a lot of speed bumps out of life. If given the opportunity to go back and restructure my life with only one change or learn one lesson, it would be to trust my intuition, my gut, my sixth sense. There are many names for the part from which I've always had and hide my highest and best interest at heart, and it revels me from which in me and these instructions and guidance it's of many forms. My life has happened entirely different from which I would have known the feeling of uneasingly as a signal that more investigation is needed before the action is taken on my part. There are so many times I blindly followed what others thought was right, others being authority figures such as parents or teachers who perfectly logical reasons and data to back up something needed to be done in a certain way. Sometimes they were correct and sometimes they were way off in their guidance. Like so many people, I gave my power away to an outer authority rather than checking my own inner authority and my intuition, or I could choose or call it God. I brought up in the middle class of my family, valued from a formal education. I had very high expectations, which I swallowed a hook, line, and a sinker. My sister became a pharmacist, my brother an attorney, my father was paying most of our expenses. My father and I didn't even get along. Me and my father didn't get along, but from the best of the best, I gave it my best shot. and I worked my way through 2 years of college, stopping because my heart wasn't in it. And all of a sudden, I didn't even want to do the next thing, but I know that I didn't want to pursue my degree. I even had something in my life that I was willing to underwrite a considerably portion of my expenses for me to continue. Even though I was grateful, it didn't influence my decision not to continue. I always believed that I could do anything. I wanted to be successful as long as I delivered the goods. This was proven as true in my life. I chose the first form of my class from Mr. Merrill Lynch. A class from Merrill Lynch at the time, from which I was 19 years old, because the stock market fascinated me. It fascinated me. I fell in love, got married, and moved into Naples, Florida, where I became a draftswoman for the Department of Transportation, DOT. I really didn't have a passion for the life, but it nudged me to start scanning classified ads for my former husband found an opening being advertised for the two stockbrokers. He wanted people where they were at least 40 years of age with experience. I had very strong desire to apply for this position. I wanted to very badly. I had just turned 25. I had no experience, but lots of willingness. I could still remember the interview as if it was yesterday. I was offered the job at half the salary that I was making now, and I was thrilled. The rest is history. I found a career from which I was passionate about. I lived and ate and breathed the industry. I became a stockbroker. 5 years later, when on 2% of the people in the industry were women, I didn't know that anything about the intuition. I didn't know anything about intuition. I didn't know about the homing device that kept me on track for so many ways. I can remember one of many instances in which I advised the client to purchase a stock because I really had a good feeling about it after I've done some research. After he had made a good profit, he sold it, and later date he wanted to buy it back. I didn't have a good feeling about it, so I told him he might want to wait. He decided to purchase it anyway. Well, you guessed it. The stock headed south, never to see the price again that it was purchased at. How many times have you said, I knew it was going to happen. I knew that was going to happen. How many times have you said, well, I knew I shouldn't have done that. If you're like that, then you're like me. You have a pretty long list of that, and it's taken years, a lot of practice for me to get the trust and the guidance that I get from God. My trust and my guidance that I get from God and above everything else is right there in me. I recently had a situation in my life in which made me understand that there are people that lie so well and convincingly that they can pass a lie detector test. This is no joke. These people are very charming. This person I encountered didn't set off any of my usual warning signals. The only way that I'd stress was the only way I knew when a person which was lying was to check within. Because my oldest child makes me the family hero, it also means that I could be a denser and brick from which it comes to getting it sometimes. I could be denser than a brick when it comes to getting it sometimes. This was certainly one of those times. It also gave me a PhD in trusting my guidance, in which I never ever forget. And when I'm learning this experience and my connection to God and the guidance from which I get an invaluable, I keep it as a personal connection with God. I read a book from about pathological liars, The Sociopath Next Door by Martha Stout, who've been studying people like this for over 20 years. The book said that the only way that you would know you'd be taken advantage of by people in this way was to know them over a long period of time. This seemed like a lot of wasted time and energy for me. Much faster way I knew was to use from which of meeting anyone was now to trust my guidance from God. When I speak before a group, I always say that a rock to an ant looks like a mountain, and a 6-foot man, it looks like a rock, and they're both correct. It's a matter of perspective. When you ask a person his or her opinion, when you're getting this in perspective or spin, every successful person in their And the more successful they are, the more they do this. Trust their intuition. There are times in which you've done all the investigation that you have, and you have all the facts, and you've consulted with the people, and you know that you can give the guidance and whose advice you trust. You know you've done all that you can to determine the course of action and which action to take. It seems obvious and logical one to take, yet there's this feeling that isn't the time or the action that needs to happen. I feel that everyone who reads this will know exactly what I'm talking about. It's been my experience and my best interest not to take the action that seems right, but to do what I'm being guided to do, even though if it flies in the face of all evidence to the contrary, to do what I feel is right, even if it flies in the face of all evidence to the contrary. After many challenging years, I finally realized what burnout meant. I knew I needed to take some time off and reflect on what I wanted and where my life was headed. When I was really getting back into my business arena, I meditated for what I wanted to do. In meditation, I was told to go to work. Silent Unity's prayer room, from which the Unity Church Prayer Ministry had been in operations for over 100 years. I have 3 shifts with approximately 25 people per shift to pray with who call in. After I received the message from meditation, I asked him, "What do you want me? You want me to do what?" I said, "You want me to do what?" I came out of meditation and thought wrong voice. Well, I went back into meditation, asked again, and got the same answer. The voice said, you'll love it more than any job you've ever had, and it won't last long. You'll love it more than any job you've ever had, and it won't last long. I asked some questions, which were answered, and then my guidance stopped. It said, go and apply, and you will get the rest of your answers. Well, I didn't do what I was told to do. My guidance dogged my heels, which very seldom does. I kept saying, you haven't gone to the silent unity yet. Well, I finally did, and I was accepted. Started $7.10 per hour, answering the phone and saying, silent unity, how may we pray with you? I absolutely loved the job. To me, it wasn't a job. 8 months after I started, Unity posted a notice of development officers and guidance said to apply for this position, which I did. When I had my final interview with Chris Jackson, senior vice president, said, Ann, did anyone look at the resume from which you applied in the prayer room? I said, Chris, I was told that my guidance to go there, and now my guidance told me to apply for this job. You guessed it. I got the position and though this position of my present career, which is calling for me, came about. I have an energy healing and a business coaching practice that spans the globe. I absolutely have the most fun when I'm working with this awesome gift. I'm humble by my magnitude from which God has touched my life, and it lives on through others, through me. And it lives on of others through me. You can learn to trust your guidance by practicing. The very best way from which you know to learn this is meditation. Most people don't do this because they think it seems to shut off their mind chatter. I studied transcendental meditation for about 25 years, and it was fabulous. I now know the process of creating a CD that will greatly reduce the eliminate the mind chatter altogether and relax your body in about 5 minutes. By the time you read this, you will be on the market. By the time you read this, it'll be on the market. When my mind is quiet and I'm at peace with not attached to the result, I get the very, very clear guidance, and I have to let it go from what I feel is the guidance it should be. Years ago, I felt like I was making up the answers, and it still felt like that. The difference is now, with practice, I come to trust it. I learn to clear out what I was asking. So when it's really important to me, I write down and revise if I'm writing until it's really clear to me what I should do. I wouldn't give up this ability for Bill Gates' net worth. Where would I be without it? I'd feel like a rudderless ship. When I'm doing work with clients, often I have issues in my mind from which I want to deal with, such as larger ones in my life and struggle, but their lists usually contain 20 to 5 different items like this. From there, always the sessions with clients go. I totally let go and trust what is done in order to make it done for the far better coming of God and anything that I could possibly come up with for my clients. Many times I'm just working with clients will say, how did you know to heal that? Because from which one of the really big issues of the client will say, you keep hitting the big ones one after another, and that was the next one on my list. I tell them, and you know it? And you know it, the same time that I do, it's when it crossed my lips. I never trust my guidance so much from when I'm in front of an audience teaching or healing or doing the same one-on-one with a client. It comes so natural to me because I've always been there. For over 10 years now, I've worked at least 2 hours every day perfecting the work. And many times, they are my favorite 2 hours of my day. Trusting my guidance is one of my major ways I've found to eliminate a lot of speed bumps out of my life. I was told that the man who founded Lord & Taylor, the famous department store, named it that because his last name was Taylor and the Lord was his guidance. Well, he thought of it first. Ann Taylor, president of Inner Healing Incorporated, www.innerhealing.com. Miracles happen all the time, no exceptions. Miracles happen all the time. You'll take them for granted. The fact that you're here is a miracle. Miracles are what happen beyond immediate comprehension. Explaining it doesn't dismiss the miracle. Scientists may describe what makes grass green. Their explanations will seem logical, but all they did was put words together in a way to try to rationalize what they can't understand. The explanation doesn't hide the miracle. Look for miracles. Confusion is the wonderful state before clarity. Confusion is the wonderful state before clarity. At all times in your life, you will become confused. It's okay. Confusion is the wonderful state before clarity. The more clutter around you, the more clutter in you. A missing secret is this, is the more clutter in your room, the more clutter in your mind. Clean out your closets, clean out your garage, clean out your office, clean out your rooms. Energize moves the blocks. Energy moves when blocks are removed. Clutter equals blocks. Get rid of the clutter. Hire someone to clean up your area if you need to, or call 1-800-GOT-JUNK to come and remove your debris. The night window is your chance to place your order. The night window is your chance to place your order. Few know what they drift, and when they drift off to sleep, that there's merging into an energy of all this, as some call this the universe. This is the opportunity to place a wish or an order, and the universe will begin to fulfill it. So as you lay in bed, make a wish. Wish for whatever you want, preferably something that makes you smile. Wish for it for yourself or for others, but wish, and then drift into sleep, smiling, trusting, knowing that it will come to be. Welcome, ghosts. I've been haunted by three ghosts in my life. The third one just appeared last month and I never knew why they picked me. But the relationship usually leads to a brief glimpse of a fame of fortune. Maybe this time won't be different. The first ghost came to me in 1989. I was reading a famous Robert Collier letter book and it came across the name Bruce Barton. I'm sure thousands have read this book before and saw the same name, but it did not have the same experience I had. I got chills. Something awakened inside of me. I began a 2-year quest to learn all that I could about a new forgotten advertising genius and a best-selling author. The result was my book, The 7 Lost Secrets of Success. It's been through 11 printings. One person bought 19,500 copies of it and gave it to them as gifts to everybody in his company. And the ghost of Barton led me to write this book. And such it touched lives around the world and continues to do so. But Bruce Barton was only the first ghost. The second ghost was P.T. Barnum, the famous showman circus promoter who came to me while I was reading the autobiography that led me to my quest to learn his business secrets. A year later, I wrote the book, There's a Customer Born Every Minute. And it's led to my audio program, The Nightingale Conant, The Power of Outrageous Marketing. The program has been a bestseller for over 5 years now. The third ghost came to me last month. I have been a fan of the Neville, the mystical writer of several books, for a decade more than even mentioned him as quote as my latest book, The Attractor Factor, and even one that causes one step in my book, The Magnificent Feeling, The Nevillese. You Nevillese a goal from which you feel inside, are you ready to have it? However, what apparently wasn't enough for Neville, a few weeks ago I noticed an article about him in a major magazine that reawakened my interest for the Barbados mystic. I searched and found some of the audios for actually recorded speeches he gave in the 1950s and 60s. I found a man who owned all known recordings of Neville. I bought all 106 of them. I felt as if Neville was speaking to me and I listened to them. I found 5 lessons Neville taught me in 1948. These are very rare. They are practical metaphysics of how to manifest your heart's desires. Pure gold. I relished the fact that I was somehow led into the lessons, but something shocking happened as I read them. Neville was talking about reading to take a ship back to the home country, he said. The boat's name was Nerissa. And in the second time I had heard this name and the name of a beloved partner from whom I have heard of 6 years now. Too weird, but the ghostly events didn't stop there. And every time in the same week I found in rare lessons, someone posted 5 books of Neville on eBay. All were first editions, perfect conditions, autographed. Neville showed up on eBay, odd enough. Neville showing up on eBay was odd enough, and the 5 signed books would appear was even stranger. Of course I bought them all. The adventure didn't stop there. A few days later, eBay notified me that another Neville item just put online bidding. I took off, and I couldn't believe what I saw. It was the original published lessons plan from the 1948 lectures I had discovered, and the manual was autographed. Then, a few days later after that, yet another Neville item went on to eBay. This turned out to be the truly rare book of 1939 called At Your Command. I never even heard of it before. Apparently neither had never the Neville fans, who had been quiet until now. And as bidding grew hot, it was only one day. People were bidding $500 for this little gem. And of course, I wasn't going to let this one slip by. I bid $1,500 for it and won it for... $1,515. Is the book worth it? I used to attract a new car, a BMW 645 CI. It was being built for me right now in Germany, so I have the ghost inside of my life. Isn't that weird enough? I paid $515 for this little book and the sharp earnings of my powers to manifest what I desire, which is today, $90,000 luxury sports car. This is getting too strange. The events were reminding me of a way of experience with Bruce Barton and P.T. Barnum. I have no idea if the ghosts of these great men were actually contacting me or not, but to have them to... You have to admit that the synchronicity of the events leading me to write these books have been uncanny. No wonder I have been a fan of Ron Serling, a man who, when I was a teenager, I lived the Twilight Zone. I'm not sure why Neville is contacting me. Maybe it's just to dust off his message and present it to a new audience, meaning you. Meanwhile, he'll notify me tonight of tomorrow. He'll notify me tonight or tomorrow, and I knew I would like his ideas made available, so I put some of them online at http://www.attractanewcar.com. There's a great lesson here. The joy in life is following a joy. What I mean is whether paying attention to these coincidences leads to a book, or whether it's important thrill of an action on them or acting on them, the adventure is in this journey, not in the destination. It's in the journey. The destination simply is a pause before the next journey. Are you acting or on nudges that you get, even if you have no idea where they will lead? If so, you will find a life exhilarating. You will find life exhilarating, and you might even meet a ghost or two. Do not strive for perfection. Do not strive for perfection. The quest for perfection is not to stop when you're getting the results throughout your life. Realize right now that perfection is a relative term. What seems to perfect to you will seem flawed to someone else, and that seems perfect to them will be ridiculous to you. It's all a matter of opinion. Do the best that you can and let go. History will judge what you have done, and more often than not, it will forget and forgive us all. Enjoy the journey. It is perfect. It's perfect as well. All is well. Perfect as is. Everything is perfect as is. John Burton. It took me several decades of living to realize that nothing is perfect if life expects that which we expect of everything. Allow me to explain. For many years, I suffered from what I call dyslexic logic. Getting cause of an effect reverse. Actually, I've come to realize that there's no such thing as cause, but that's just for another time. For a long time, I used to think, like many people do, I do have a certain way to achieve a certain level of success in order to gain self-worth. I believe to stave off some nagging sense of inferiority to imperfection, I simply must make perfect choices and behave in perfect ways. At best, self-worth would be temporary byproduct of the perfect acts. The chase was on. Of course, the degree of success was frustratingly inconsistent only to the awareness of leaky self-worth and fueling the pursuit of much more. After years of enduring the chase of worth, anguishing wrestling with myself, each solution seeking from my friends, books, my professionals, I experienced it might be considered an empathy. I came to realize that my worth actually preceded my and every thought and deed. My life's worth actually preceded my any and every thought and deed. Well, this changed everything. Now I reconfigured countless beliefs of myself, now in my life and of others. Not a paradigm shift or a paradigm expansion, an awareness expansion, as through a veil, obscuring my awareness had been lifted. Knowing that my worth proceeds from my thoughts and my deeds removes the need for perfection as I, and you, and everyone else is already fine from the beginning of life. I do wish I'd known this long ago. I imagine many different life choices, and yet knowing and experiencing this pre-existing self-worth now softens the regret as well. As an analogy for self-worth always being present, consider the moon up in the night sky. One night you look up in the starry sky and see only a sliver of a moon. Another week you might look at the night sky and perhaps see half of a moon. Eventually you see a full moon shining down on you. Now, if you did any better, don't you swear the moon shrinks and expands through the moon? But know full well that the moon remains the same size night after night after night after night. Part of the moon is to illuminate varies, and part of the moon that it illuminates varies. But the moon remains the same. It is the same situation with you and your worth. The only thing that changes is your awareness of it. I am not no human imperfect, yet we made perfectly. Yet we were made perfectly. Our very being stems from the made of up of worthiness. We cannot exist otherwise. Knowing this, feeling this, confirming this daily reminds me that I retain a constant and irrevocable worth. I contain a constant and irrevocable worth. I can use it however I choose, with no risk to my worth. So many is not of all the life's choices, errors, dishonoring a self of others stem from the belief that we can and have already lost our worth. Verifying self-worth before taking any action naturally leads to a positive, constructive choices. I came to realize that I, you, every tree and every blade of grass and every raindrop and snowflake are already exactly perfect, as is. Paraphrase from the unpublished manuscript, The Myth of Original Sin, Remembering Aboriginal Unity by John Burton, Ed D. How you really feel does matter. Mandy Evans. Lots of people just plain flat out do not want to deal with their emotions. They don't want to feel them. They don't want to talk about them. Often they wish that they would just go away. No wonder. If you grew up human on planet Earth, you probably learned early in the expressing that your feeling led to trouble. Ever try squealing, laughing, jumping of joy in a second grade classroom or at the dinner table? By third grade, most of us understood that it never pays us to show any anger at a teacher or at a heartbreak for being left out of a game at recess for total frustration of not being able to understand long division. We learned to hide, overcome, repress, suppress, and deaden our feelings any way that we could, even if it took a large amount of alcohol, drugs, hour after hours of mindless TV to do it. Day by day, we learned more rules about appropriate emotional responses and less about emotional freedom. However, the feelings keep coming. For the first part of my life, I thought that the way to change my life, I felt, was to change my circumstances in my life. Most people I know learn the same approach. And so begins the endless struggle to improve everything. Lose weight, earn money, get a better car, find true love, get rid of your old true love, move to a bigger house. Here's a lesson, I think, that we should learn to get early on. How you feel really does matter. How you feel is up to you. Before you make a life-changing move to hope for the feeling of the better, always deal with your feelings first. Because if you quit your job and you leave your marriage in anger, find out about your anger. What is it about? Why do you feel the way that you feel? Before you go on a diet, leave town, buy a new car, or get married, or you could stop emotional pains. Deal with your feelings first. You must still want to lose the weight, get a car, create a new adventure, but it'll be a completely different experience with a far different outcome. Because regardless of whether what we like, emotions rocket fuel our manifestations. We hear it from people people from which teach visualization techniques to overcome serious illness from the motivational speakers who command enormous corporate fees is to work it out. Whatever it is that you want to achieve, you've got to feel it first. This mysterious law of the universe works regardless whether you're aware of it or not, regardless of whether you believe it or not, regardless whether you're consciously aware of it or not, whether you're consciously aware of it. The emotional state always has and always will be a profound effect on what happens next in your life. The mysterious law of the universe works regardless whether you're aware of it or not. It's when you hear your visualization techniques to overcome serious illness and motivational speakers command enormous corporates that you believe what you think about. The choices you make in actions and you take from when you are afraid lead down to different roads and choices and actions which you make you happy. The solution you find to a problem when you feel guilty will not be the same ones you find when you feel at peace. Feelings actually cause things to happen. Feelings influence events. Getting, doing, having stuff is nice. Fame, fortune, and good looks stand out among most popular getting stuff goals. However, there's not a whole lot of correlation between getting stuff and the happiness of the Madison Avenue, Hollywood, and the Wall Street that you believe it is that it produces. We all know that people who stand out for their talent, financial achievements, beauty, or might, or deeds, but they're not happy. You see people who stand out and they're not happy. The mind-boggling part is that they do not want to be happy yet. They do not know that happiness is a real option for them, that they do not know how to choose it. Your emotional experience of life is so important. When you feel curious, grateful, loving, and happy, life seems like a precious gift. But if you are ridden, guilt filled with fear and angry, no one can ever enter your heart. And you're so resentful that joy is not only irritating word, but life is more like hell on earth. What good are fame and fortune goods like in hell? As we wander around the paradise called Earth, this perception is what happens to and combines our thoughts and beliefs about what life means. The ever-changing combination produces emotional responses. When we judge events, circumstances as good for us, we usually respond with some form of happiness. When we look bad things that are happiness, we respond with anger, fear, and guilt and sorrow, and others are so-called negative emotions. But what happens when you suspend that judgment? When life becomes fascinating as a fascinating mystery and unfolding in the midst of infinite possibilities, you become more and more and more free to choose your feelings. You can allow your love and creativity and joy into your life than you have dreamed possible simply by asking yourself from time to time, if I could feel any way that I wanted to feel, it would be. You may come up with the answers that will astound you. Exercising your emotional options allows you to experience life on your own terms in the most real way possible. It's like magic. You can create a result first. You can be happy even before you change all those things that you wanted to change. Mandy Evans is the author of Emotional Options, a handbook for happiness and the traveling free, how to recover from the past of changing your beliefs. For more information about her books, free belief quiz, visit www.mandyevans.com. Forgiveness, Jeremy Likeness. Forgiveness. One gift I wish I had to receive earlier in life is the knowledge of forgiveness. I spent much of my life carrying rusty anchors with me. It's difficult for me to move forward with carry bitterness inside. I can believe it now. All the times that I've held onto those grudges, I would literally bathe in a poisoning of thoughts. Now I realize that those thoughts did nothing for the person that I was holding a grudge against. It didn't bother them one bit. What it did was hold me back and prevent me from becoming my best. Forgiveness isn't much about the people. Sometimes we have trouble forgiving the things around us. I used to wake up in fear, angry at the universe. Starting the day I first took flight in the mode of a stressful way to begin the day. Perhaps I was worrying about the bills, or angry about my car accident, or some other event that appeared to be beyond my control. When I found forgiveness, I quickly learned that forgiving is a process. I cannot say I forgive and then let go. Many of the anchors I carried with me had to be embedded, and were embedded deep within. So I had to constantly remind myself to toss them out. I would say, I forgive and I release you. And imagine the face of a person I held a grudge against. It felt great. They went on with their own lives, but now I was free to live mine. My next step was to forgive the world around me. I suddenly stopped blaming my misfortunes of the universe. Traffic happens. Rain happens. All this is a part of life. And when I became friends with the universe, not by holding a grudge, the universe returned gestures by providing abundance. This is when I started to learn about success, because success doesn't find selfish people. Not forgiving is a very selfish act. And if you think about having money and success find rich people that doesn't know how to forgive, and that you might discover being rich for them is nothing more than expensive unhappiness. Then, in all my forgiveness, I stumbled upon the greatest gift of all. I forgave myself. I learned that I could love myself, forgive myself for not being perfect. I used to be my own enemy. I know enjoyment now, and I live and receive so much more, especially now that I can be friends with the reflection I see in the mirror. Jeremy Likeness is a health coach, motivational speaker, and author. Jeremy learned to forgive himself through the process of shedding 65 pounds of fat. Jeremy became a certified fitness trainer, specialist in performance nutrition. He specializes in assisting others in releasing their thoughts that create overweight and obesity. See www.naturalphysiques.com. Logic doesn't exist. Logic doesn't exist. What we call logic is simply rationalization. After all, one person's total logic argument often makes no sense to another person. If logic did exist, we would all agree. We don't. We don't buy the same cars, clothes, houses, vote the same politicians, and the same philosophies about life. Yet we have perfectly logical reasons for everything else that we do and say and believe. Giving is like that. It defies logic. When you give anything, you tap into a higher spiritual law, you know, from which you but give, but wait and receive. But this may seem strange again, but it's not logical. And intuitive, it's spiritual. It's innate in the way the universe operates. All you have to do to get out from way, get out of the way and let it cook. What you do is get out of its way and let it cook. Let me give you a story to illustrate my point. A person read on one of my latest books, The Greatest Money-Making Secret in History, and I decided to try it. He saw a radio, I saw an audio set that I knew a friend that he wanted it, and he bought it. He saw an audio set, he knew a friend of his wanted it, so he bought it, and he gave it to his friend. And it was good deed, because he knew that there would be a given or received in a segment worth $117,000, how it would be possible. Now, how is this possible? It could have ended there, but the giver did receive an assignment worth of over $117,000. How's this possible? It is possible. If you look at the event logically, reasonably, personally, can get giving and saying how nothing to do with the getting. But what is this toss logic out the window? But what if you just toss logic out of the window? Let's toss logic out of the window. Take another example. Another person read my book Starting and Giving. He wrote back saying, my weekly income has gone up 113% in the last week. This is my best week financially of the year. New clients started calling me from all over the place. I've never had so many new customers in a week. Did his giving lead to his increase? You bet. Again, it defies logic. At least it defies human logic. We are accustomed to giving and holding out our hands out without no expectation of return means that we won't get a return. That's our logical argument anyways. However, that isn't the case. Not in real life. Not here on planet Earth. When you give yourself, you receive. Period. When you give yourself, you receive. When you really ask, when you're really asked to do what you give and trust, I wear an ancient Roman gold ring on my hand. It's estimated to be 2,500 years old. It has the worth of fidem engraved on it, which is Latin for faith. It is a reminder to me to trust that when I give, I will receive someday, some way, from someone. All I have to do is practice the principle. To give, you will receive. It is the greatest money-making secret in history. It's just not logical. How to make a decision. How to make a decision. Few people know this, but any decision is acceptable when you can't decide. This trick is to make a decision right because you made it. In other words, when you're torn between two roads, pick any of them that make the one that you picked. Make sure that you pick the one that you feel is right. In the grand scheme of things, it doesn't matter. But if you can't down the road enough to know, which decisions to make, then no one can fault. No one can fault you for making a decision. Of course, in a pinch, you can always flip a coin. So when it comes to making a decision, few people know this, but any decision is acceptable when you can't decide. The trick is to make a decision right because you made it. In other words, when you are torn between two roads, pick one and then make one that you picked right. In the grand scheme of things, it doesn't matter. But if you can't see down the road enough to know which decision to make, then no one can fault you for making a decision. Of course, in a pinch, you could always flip a coin. You will always want to be right. And rarely be. You'll always want to be right and rarely will be. Throughout your life, you will see people lie, steal, cheat, and maybe even kill in order for the right. This is built into your survival mechanism. The truth is, the mechanism is no longer necessary. What is necessary in your life is a note from which is the works that doesn't work. Do your best to ignore being right and focus instead of getting the results you want. Again, don't think about being right. Think about getting the results that you want. Be willing to surrender the habits of old ways and being in favor of new habits from which the new ways will lead you to your desired outcomes. Said in other ways, you will want to be right in your arguments. But even if the other person stops arguing, they will still consider the viewpoint wrong. To them, they are right. To you, you are right. To the universe, you are both right. You will find happiness, peace, faster routes to success when you give up being right. Right? Everything you hear isn't true. Don't believe everything you hear. If you hear something positive about another, embrace it. If you hear something negative about someone, be quiet. Observe. Learn the truth for yourself. If you want to keep yourself in check, here's a helpful tip. Helpful tip to keep yourself in check. Always talk about others as if they were in the same room with you, listening. This technique will give you the immediate perspective on what you should and should not be saying. Judgment is not evil. I've heard many people choose on the not to judge, but if judgment of some come, form of evil. It is important to remember the difference between judgment, gloating over someone else's inadequacies and differences, and discrimination. Discrimination eater chooses specific healthy foods for their well-being. Eating a salad is not a judgment of gravity challenging individuals. It is a self-sustaining choice. If you do not wish to be around smokers and their smoke, discriminating in such a way that keeps your smoke free isn't a judgment about smokers. It is a demonstration of one's courage to choose for self. Names do hurt. Names do hurt. Along the course of your life, you will hear the phrase, sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt me. It's a lie. In many ways, names will hurt far more, and the pain lasts far longer than any stick or stone. Predicting the end of the world will make you look bad. Predicting the end of the world will make you look bad. People throughout history have predicted the world's end. They've always been wrong. No exceptions. None. The word to the wise, throughout many of the times you feel the world will end, and it won't. So rather than being a messenger of doom and gloom, which won't win any friends over to make you feel good anyway, or yeesayer, predict the world will last a long time. It will, at least longer than your own lifetime. All time happens now. Time is an illusion. Although you may never be able to wrap your head around this concept, all time happens right now. The past is gone. You remember it now, and you remember it inaccurately, but it past is gone. And even though it's gone, you remember it right now, you remember it inaccurately, because the past is gone. The future hasn't even happened yet, and when it gets here, it will be now. All that happened before and all that will happen are illusions. The only thing that matters, the only thing that is real, is now. All time happens now. What is time for? What time is for? I was reading The Architects of All Abundance by Ledger Carroll, mother and singer of Jewel. She advises you to ask yourself, what is time for? It means right now. What is there for you to do? Right now, what is there for you to do? What is appropriate, falling into place, ready to hatch? Rather than forcing what you want to happen, see what wants to be done now. What is time for? Most things self-correct in time. Larry Andrews. Optimal performance. Getting the best out of your life. Indian wisdom. Two wolves. An elder, Cherokee, was teaching his grandchildren. He said to them, a fight is going on inside of me. It is a terrible fight. It is between two wolves. One wolf represents fear, anger, envy, sorrow, regret, greed, arrogance, self-pity, guilt, resentment, inferiority, lies, false pride, superiority, and ego. The other stands for joy, peace, love, hope, sharing, serenity, humility, kindness, benevolence, friendship, empathy, generosity, truth, compassion, and faith. And the same fight is going on inside of you and inside of every other person too. They thought about it for a minute. Then one child asked his grandfather, which wolf will win? The old Cherokee simply replied, the one you feed. Don't be afraid to ask for help. Most people want to do things by themselves to feel good about themselves and their accomplishments, although ultimately you will do things by yourself. Asking for help is not a sign of weakness. Great people are always willing to lend a hand to those who are asking for help out of sincere desire to grow and change for the better. Whether you need direction or alone, don't be afraid to ask for help. To change, burn your bridges. At some point in your life, you will decide that you will want to change something, whether it's to quit smoking, which you should never have started, or quit drinking, or quit overeating, or whatever. However, saying I want to change isn't enough to actually change. Yes, it's the beginning of the process, but it will stop there if you don't go to the next step. The next step is to burn your bridges. Make it impossible to go back to the old habit or way of being. This is meant of creating uncomfortable scenarios as if you fail. In other words, if you say you will lose 25 pounds at the end of the season or donate your car to a person or cause you don't like, and you have a leverage for yourself for success. The lesson here is that you can motivate yourself to change with your decision, with your lesson to succeed in creating a win-win for yourself, knowing that you cannot fail because your bridges have been burned. What to do when you are afraid, Dr. Lorena Case. I've learned an important life lesson both personally and through my training as a psychologist. Although I've learned it is an accident initially, it is only the one that works for better from when you do it on purpose. I will tell you about it so you can look for ways to purposefully do the things differently to reduce fear, improve happiness, and increase your chances of success in your life's end of wars. Here's the lesson. Whenever you are afraid, uncomfortable, nervous, or worried, do the opposite of what you would have naturally do. which you would naturally do. Fear is one of the most common human emotions from which we all have the things that we are afraid of. Many children worry about going to school, being afraid of animals or new activities. Adults commonly fear public speaking, interpersonal conflicts, flying, and other things from which we perceive are threatening or potentially embarrassing. The common response to fear is to try to reduce it. If your child is anxious, you will naturally go to help him or her feel better. By this process, people have to learn to avoid experiencing fear. Although this is a natural response, it is also the least helpful response. The more you avoid experiencing anxiety, from the more your discomfort and you allow it to grow over time, you will be facing your fear eventually. Miss out on many important activities because you're living within a comfort zone. You may also miss out on learning when do you allow yourself to experience the anxiety. It naturally goes away on its own. My message to you is to push yourself to get out of the comfort zone from which you may be living in. This will then enter to a place from where your tremendously personal and professional success will begin. This is true in many areas of life. Think about it. When you first started dating someone, you may have had butterflies and nervousness, but you avoided these feelings so you missed out on the wonderful relationship. But you may have an uncomfortability with speaking up in front of a class or at work. Yet you confronted your anxieties, and over time your confidence grew and your fear shrunk. When you feel anxious or anxious or uncomfortable, tell yourself that those feelings are wonderful because it means that you are pushing yourself to get over your fears, fully experiencing life. You become more confident in the complete human being. Dr. Lorena Case, President and Performance of Success Coaching, LLC, co-authored the ebook End Self-Sabotage at www.endselfsabotage.com. My Inherited Fear of Financial Ruin, Dr. Robert Anthony. For many years, I struggled with money issues. It wasn't until later in life that I realized why. I was raised in a family where money was always an issue. Actually, the issue was the lack of money, especially from my father. My father was raised as an only child in a poor Italian immigrant family. When the Great Depression hit in 1929, my grandparents, like many other people, lost their life savings because the banks closed down without notice, leaving them virtually broke. At the time, there was no FDIC insuring to protect the money that you had in the bank. They also lived in the cold, eliminate climate of the cold East Coast during the days from which most homes were heated by coal furnaces. In order to heat their homes, my father would have to go to the railroad tracks where the trains brought the coal for the coal yard, and others would pick up the pieces of the coal that fell on the railroad cars. This is the only way that they could afford to heat their house. During that time, life was so difficult for my father and my grandparents that the years later, even the things to improve to my father was financially comfortable. He never got over those Great Depressions. He relived the Great Depression in his mind every day for the rest of his life. When I was growing up, all my father would talk about was the fact that he can never do anything or earn so much money as possible, and the worst yet had always to be of the lookout for the independent danger that will always take away all of our money. So what you do suppose became my reality about money. There was never enough. I have never earned so much possible to protect myself against a loss. There's a good chance I will eventually lose what I have. Now, here it all's a sad part. Even after I became an adult and even earned my own profession and learned enough on my own profession, it was the amount that most people considered very substantial, I still didn't have enough. No matter what I had learned, I was always getting by, and of course I was afraid to lose what I had, which I did on several occasions. As you see, I inherited my father's money issues. Unfortunately, I will inherit our parents' issues about money unless we consciously change them. And you'll inherit your parents' money issues unless you consciously change them. Now looking back, it is so clear why I kept myself broke. I brought myself into this belief from my childhood into the rest of my life. I didn't even see what I was doing. Don't get me wrong, I was always motivated to try to make a lot of money, but I was always operating out of a mentality that there isn't enough and I will eventually lose what I have. And guess what? That's what my reality was. The law of cause and effect, or the attractor factor, was at work, and I didn't even know it. It was all in the truth, so no matter how long or hard I had worked, I had always ended up at the same result. No matter how much money I had earned, and trust me, it was a lot, I either got by or managed to lose it, and all the time I was worrying about I was going to make more money. What is important is to outstand and to understand here is the motivation for making money was based off my fear of not having enough and losing what I had. So, as embarrassed as I want to admit, living this way was forever in my 40s and my years of life. 40 years of my life was the part of the most embarrassing which I had in my business of helping people to become successful, yet I was a financial failure. Here I was thinking about talking about and working hard about wealth, studying success, financial success out of my own speech and reach, and it's out of my own reach. The end result was that my dominant thoughts prevailed. Keep in mind, I didn't consciously do this to myself. However, while I was going on, I blamed my parents, poor business decisions, my mate, government, extenuating circumstances, my lack of financial success. Well, I finally was fortunate to learn that the most important life lesson that I'd ever learned was we attract whatever we focus on. And said another way, we become what we think about all day long. What people must do to understand is that we do not attract what we want, we attract what we focus on. Almost everyone desires more money in their lives, but obviously wanting it is not the key to having it. You must Remember that you become what you think about, and we attract what we focus on. If you currently experience anxiety, scarcity, depression, or an inability to attract what you desire, you must take a look at how you have been attracting these things into your life. You must look at an attractor pattern for these things. These things show up in your life because you have been consciously or unconsciously focusing on them. If you still do not have what you want, you are not on a certain vibrational path. Simply put out the focusing of what you don't want instead of what you do want. All the obstacles you face in your life are the result of vibrationing mismatch. Until you decide to constantly connect your higher vibrations level, you will remain stuck with what you are. Here is the secret. If you change your way of looking at things, the things you look at will change. See how you look at life. Your life is essentially based on what you believe to be true by yourself to determine your level of expectations. These expectations are based on your belief in limitations, scarcity, and pessimism about what's possible for you. These beliefs form a basis of how you look at life, and your perception creates your own experience. So that you now have in your own mind, you don't have what you can create. You cannot create what you'll be determined by your own limitational viewpoints of impossibility. These beliefs form a basis of how you look at life, and that perception creates what you experience. So what you have, you don't have, is what you can create or cannot create will be determined by your limiting viewpoints of impossibility. The source energy within you is limitless, and because you are one of the source's energy of the universal creating mind, the possibilities for you are also limitless. However, the source of energy can also work within you and for you when you are in harmony within it. Source energy is the universal creative mind in a constant state of supplying everything that we can possibly imagine. It takes orders 24/7. It never shuts down, never takes hideaways, sick leave, or any days off. It is perpetually there to take orders and supply you. Source of your universal creative mind. The source of your universal creative mind. Is this true? Is this why some people are able to access this flow while others feel separated from it? The answer is simple. If it is always giving you and ask you for your experiencing shortages in your life, then you are creating resistance to allow it to come into your life. You are placing resistance in the way of your natural flow of whatever you desire. If the universe based on the laws of energy and attraction means everything is vibrating at a particular frequency, then you are vibrating at a frequency that is contradiction to what you desire. This is what I had so many financial problems for 40 years. It had nothing to do with my money, my vibrations of harmony with which I desired instead of creating my resistance from which I desired. I, while trying to attract it at the same time, thoughts that emphasize lack, limiting fears, scarcities, and worthlessness set up in a contradiction in the energy, and the contradiction creates a field of disallowing. In essence, you are not in harmony with your desires. Remember that you are part of a universal creative mind, and if you put yourself into a non-resistant state of mind, which means that you are in harmony with your desires, then source energy in the universal creative mind will work for harmony with your desires. It has no choice for the matter. It can only act upon your thoughts and your feelings and have no vibrational contradiction to your desire. You don't need to be overwhelming on this act. In fact, you really don't need to change anything. Instead, to say to yourself, the only thing I have control over my own thoughts is about allowing what I desire to come into my life right now. More importantly, it doesn't matter what I have, therefore, for how long or how many pressures I am under that moment. Instead, I'm going to stop generating more contradictory thoughts today, one at a time. You do this by affirming that I can create anything I desire because I refuse to allow anything or anyone that is not in harmony with my desires to run my life. I allow whatever I desire to come into my life right now. I allow whatever I desire to come into my life right now. When you activate this thought enough times, it will become a habit and eliminate your resistance to allowing your desires to manifest itself in your life. And as you practice this path of least resistance, it is no longer something that you choose. It is something that you are. This is when your miracles begin to happen. And you will now continue to happen for the rest of your life as long as you focus on what you want instead of what you don't want. So don't waste 40 years of your life creating a reverse instead of learning what life lessons will open your doors to abundance the rest of your life. Dr. Robert Anthony, the legend in personal development and author of many books including Beyond Positive Thinking. You are playing the role of victim. Are you playing the role of victim? Nerissa Odin, are you playing the role of victim? How would you ever know if you were playing the role if you were reared that way from birth? Ask yourself these six questions. Number one, are the cards stacked against you? Number two, are you plagued by bad luck? Were or are you held back from succeeding? Does your work mostly go unnoticed? Was modern society set up by privileged few? Does society disrespect you and your kind? If you answered yes to any of these questions, you are playing the role of a victim. Now get a grip. Throughout human history, there has been an unequal distribution of power and inheritance. The things that remember us from a couple can overcome a mass inequality for the individual level. For example, women have always fought for the next to be next to men, to become a business owners, even cultural icons, as well as during the times from which these were culturally forbidden, even illegal. Women who achieved these goals did so by poising as men. Most were discovering or written about, but enough were discovering most upon their death. The forge of new reality, these women saw an opportunity and took it. They didn't let anything like clothing or sex interfere with their dream and freedom of equality. Many of you might just as read, but I am different of color and handicapped or of this or that, and I'm more easily identified than a woman with her breasts bound. Victim. There are many, many stories of success of an individual level. Gay couples poisoning relatives, living together for the whole lives, African Americans escaped and relocated, children who overcame cruel parents, and more. So, before you choose a lifelong victim as yourself, where are your opportunities? Should I relocate? Should I pick a better friend? Should I get a better job? Go back to school, get a roommate, and save money? What does my intuition say? Talk to a family or more. Talk to my family less. Well, I'm sure that you can think of many more questions that goes in the guide of self-betterment. Now, to get you closer to your goals, listen to your heart. Make choices that actively serve your better for yourself. Anything less is choosing life as a victim. Everything in the world should be chosen off of your heart. You are the only one who can choose your life that you live. Narissa Odin is a video editor and author. See the www.thevideoqueen.com. How to get a job. Let the beauty we love, but what we love. Now, let the beauty we love be what we do. Let the beauty we love be what we do. Let's do the beauty that we love. And let the beauty we love be what we do. Zelurin Rumi, 13th century Sufi poet and mystic. Be willing to work for free. Mark Twain advised it. Many successful people got their first jobs by being apprentices, by basically said, I'll work for you for free for 2 months. If you like me, hire me. If you don't, let me go. Another way for the job is to be less concerned about what it is. Look around and I'll see your work. It may not be what you want, but it's a start. Numerous famous and wealthy people began as a busboy, cooks, and taxi drivers. Many people came into this country with no money, no job, no ability to speak this language, and yet went to create fortunes. There is work. Accept it, and you will have your first job. Get a pet. Having a pet can lower your blood pressure, release your stress, and also can open your heart and teach you love. Of course, having a pet could increase your blood pressure and increase your stress, so choose your pet wisely. I know a woman who loves exotic animals. Her first panther led to a chimpanzee, zebras, wombats, and more, and that this hobby led to an opening of a safari. People come from all over the country to see her exotic collection, and of course, if raising a baboon sounds stressful to you, then consider owning a turtle. Illness is a call from your body. Illness is a call from your body, so you don't need to get sick. Years ago, I got the flu, and when I spoke to the healer about it, he pointed out that getting the flu was the moment of once you flee or run away from something. I thought about it and realized that I wanted to flee my job at the time. Once I realized that I had created my illness, I had to make excuses for not working, I could no longer get the flu again. Most likely, and illnesses are like that. You'll get to create your own attention. They'll come from a metaphor or something in your life. For example, one time I was angry about a friend who was doing what he was doing. Shortly after that, I got a boil on my chest, and it was full of pus, and it needed to be opened and released. How much more relevance can you get? I was boiling over anger and was full of pus in my friend's behavior, and it manifested itself on my body. Whenever you get ill, look for a hidden reason for the illness. Most likely, once you find it, the illness will vanish. Pay your taxes. As a citizen in a country where you live, you will be asked to contribute to the government's expenses. You resent this and resist it and lease it for the first, but ultimately, you'll have to pay. If you enjoy numbers and laws, you'll want to learn about the ways to save money in your taxes. If you don't enjoy the subjects, then consider hiring somebody who does. Either way, pay your taxes. You'll find life easier. The favorite question of your mind can drive you batty. The favorite question of your mind can drive you batty. What is your favorite question of your mind? Few realize this, but it simply is what if? The mind asks, what if what happens? What if this happens, if that happens? Of the two control you if you're afraid or run circles around you and keep you jailed unless you ignore it. When your mind asks what if and plays a negative movie in your mind, change it by asking, well, what if, and play a positive scenario. As always, you were in control. But you may forget that a lot throughout your life. You may forget that a lot throughout your life, but attach positive comments to your what ifs. Specifications. What you need to know about others. People idolize the past, complain about the present, and they fear the future. I often hear people say that we live in a stressful times today, and a quick look at history, however, reveals that we are richer, healthier, happier now than any time in world history ever. Yet, we all long for the good old days, as well as we complain about the present and fear the future. If you want to make more friends in sales, tie your product to a nostalgia of the past and or urge people to buy now to solve an agony of a present or convince them that your business will make an uncertain future less risky. Until more people are enlightened and realize now is the point of power and the moment of greatest joy. choice. You can increase your happiness by playing to what people already believe. And they believe that the past, they idolize it. They complain about the present and they fear the future. Now, people never question their own beliefs, so don't try to change them. Socrates encouraged us to know ourselves, but most people don't realize they're just a fish in a pool of water. They don't question being a fish or see the water. We are all in the trance of one sort of another, believing what our doctors, lawyers, or salespeople, or what have you. The deepest beliefs our parents had given us already questioned. To awaken, question all. People will tend to say yes if you start them saying yes. Popular stage magician CJ Johnson and I were having lunch, and he told me he had a great idea for a new headline, and it was, "Do you make as much money performing magic as your neighbors make with their real jobs?" I told CJ I liked the headline, but wanted him to change it so that it could only be answered with a yes. He insisted the question could be answered with a no. See, his existing question could be answered with a no, which would put his prospect into a no mindset. Now, I suggested CJ put his headline to read, "Would you like to make as much money performing magic as your neighbors make with their real jobs?" Now people can say yes and get into the mindset of the yes mindset. Now, once they'll tend to say yes, once you ask them to buy. And you can use this principle in every conversation when looking for a date, as well as a business presentations and anything else. People do things only for the good feelings that they get. Think about it. Why did you ever buy a new car, a new dress, new tool set? Why did you buy from some level of items from which you feel better? My life partner just bought a new lawnmower. She would probably never admit of buying it made her feel better, but the truth is, from no buying it, it would make her feel worse. Keep both sides of the inside of the mind from which trying to sell people. Remind them that what happens if they don't buy. Continue the pain and remind them that what happens if they do buy, the pleasure. Focus on the good feelings and you'll increase sales. Remember, even if you aren't in sales, you will always be selling, or selling yourself or your ideas or personality, your beliefs, or so forth. People will pay any amount of money to have their inner states changed. People aren't happy. They have a desperate black sinking feeling within themselves and silently gnaw at themselves saying, life can be better than this. They'll pay any amount of money to feel better, often illegally. They'll line up to take terrifying rides of roller coasters, sit on theaters to watch horror flicks and scream in fear, and they'll pay to help you feel better, anything other than from what they feel right now. When you serve them, treat them like royalty. They'll often sell them a product, make them sure their offering is fun, unique, and conversational, and conversional, and controversial. Change their inner state, and they will make you rich. People want to be happy, period. Thoreau said, the best thing he said in his Mass of Men, he meant women too, I'm sure, led lives of quiet desperation. I learned many years ago that many than anything else in the world, people want to be happy. More than anything else in the world, people want to be happy. And when I go to any place of business, clerk, owner, person on the phone is upbeat and friendly and makes me feel upbeat and happy, they'll always get repeat business. Now, you can help people feel happy. Treat them with respect. Show your humor. Radiate your own happiness and you'll attract more sales and win more friends. Because people want to be happy, period. People respond to flattery. You are really smart by reading this. You are really smart by reading this. Few people are wise enough to be aware to invest in a book like this to help them lead happier lives. You're the exception. And like everyone else, you like to think smart, hip, sexy, popular, and often positive traits. Note how you felt when you began reading this paragraph. Didn't you feel good as if what you were reading, you are really smart to be reading this? Didn't you also feel good about from people how smart you are? Didn't you also feel good about me for noting how smart you are? Everyone responds to flattery. You, me, everyone responds to flattery. People will never argue with you if you never make them wrong. When someone calls you and complains, listen, don't argue. Don't make them wrong. As long as you can remain to constantly, I never make you wrong. Remain neutral. This will resolve an issue with a friend. It'll win a friend. And the same principle works in every other aspect of your life. It may, as far as challenging to do, because you have to keep your ego in check. You want to be right, regardless of whether you are or not. But you cannot win an argument, and you'll win an argument if you don't argue. Besides, arguing just escalates to the argument. Neither of you will win, and you'll lose a customer or a friend or a mate for life. People never, ever argue with you if you never make them wrong. Now, people always act for positive reasons, even if the behavior is negative. People always act for positive reasons, even if the behavior is negative. Some of these truisms are tough to swallow. People always act positive reasons. Always? Yes, always. No exceptions. Even the person who is hurting another in the same way is crying out, and only for what he or she knows from she's heard to express something. The person isn't wrong, their behavior is. close to home to employee doesn't do his job and the stills is doing the best that he can. The customer will routinely complain how he still be doing the best that he or she can. The children who keep getting into trouble may still be saying they're doing the best that they can. The point is not to condemn the person at all. It's to separate them from what they do. Focus on their activity. Don't judge them. You want to keep your life afloat. People work perfectly when what they do doesn't work perfectly for you. Find a way what the person needs to achieve from what they are trying to get and help them get it. People will respond to you if you get out of your ego and into theirs. Now, people will respond to you if you get out of your ego and into theirs. Who would you rather talk about today, me or you? I'm betting that you prefer to talk about yourself. When someone shows you a group of photographs of your family, whose face do you look at first? Yours, of course. When you're talking to prospects, writing for a customer, or any other interacting with people, focus on them and you'll increase your sales and deepen your friendships. Why? Because people quite naturally are interested in themselves first. It's not wrong. In fact, it's the key to your wealth. That people will respond to you if you get out of your ego and get into theirs. People want to be recognized. People want to be recognized. Carl Stevens is a famous salesperson, author, speaker, and trainer. He once told me that he entered a world sales contest, not for the trip to Hawaii, but for the winner would receive, but for the attention that he got from his peers for being the best salesperson that they had. Stroking egos can be the big money maker for you, recognition from customers, family, and friends. One year, on his first birthday card I received from anyone from his Radio Shack. This was 5 years ago. I never was a fan of them until that moment. Acknowledge your customers, family, and friends, and you can keep them for life. People universally feel deprived. Few of us are satisfied. We feel cheated by life. We expect more and feel deprived from what we don't get. We are much like babies in adult bodies, and we make more money. But we make more money, make people feel fulfilled, serve them, cherish them, give them more than what they expect, surprise them with little gifts, notes, or even visits. Show that you care, because people universally do feel deprived. People are collectors of something, whether books, thimbles, recipes. Though they may deny it, people are collectors of something. I told this truism to a friend and he said, yeah, people are funny, but sure, I don't collect anything. Yeah, it's on the shelf of every video in the James Bond 007 series. You want a quick way to get rich? Specific groups of which people are collecting sell those somethings from with the same category. Write booklets about 007 and you may get my friend's money. Find people who already buy weightless products and you can probably sell them another weightless product. Although, they would never admit it, they collect weightless products. Weight loss products, in the hope that one of them will work one day. People will continue with a bad habit until it hurts. It takes a lot of people to change, usually a lot of pain. Don't expect to see anyone change as soon, but do expect them to sell them ways to change easily. Sell them the dream, and they will likely to buy. Just sell them the dream. Tell them what it'll take to work hard and will rarely buy. But if that's the truth, respect the fact that people will continue to smoke, drink, and overeat, or whatever they think their bad habit is, and continue to offer them workable solutions. They'll buy, and one day they may even change. Because people will continue with a bad habit until it hurts. You have to remember that. Sell them a dream and they will be likely to buy. Tell them that it'll take hard work, but they will rarely buy, even if that's the truth. Respect the fact that people will continue to do their habits, but the habit if they continue to offer you, as long as you continue to offer workable solutions, they will buy one day. They may even change. People will do whatever they want, whatever you want, as long as they don't have to counterfeit to your request. Handle the objection and they will comply. People will do whatever you want, as long as they don't have to counterthought to your request. Handle the objection and they will comply. As long as they don't have to counter thought to your request, handle the objection and they will comply. Hypnotists know this. They cannot get you to do something that goes against your core values and beliefs, not unless that they change your core values and beliefs. Your friends, family, and prospects are the same. If they want you to buy a product, they will do so. If they have concerns, they won't buy until they resolve those issues. The best thing to do is to handle objections before they come up. Then, when you ask them to buy or go out with you, they will comply. People feel that someone else is in control and desperately seek ways to have power again. How many times a day do you hear yourself or others complain about them or they? Complaining about them or they. They won't let us park there, or their new rules suck. This unnamed power makes people feel impotent. Impotent. These unnamed powers make people feel impotent. As a result, they feel eager to feel in control. Offer them a way to have more power to beat the system, and you'll have their attention. Again, people feel that someone else is in control and desperately seek ways to have power again. People will follow commands that make them feel superior. You are part of a small group of people, and this group is highly intelligent, perceptive, and on leading edge of growth people. How does this make you feel? Don't you feel the sense of pride? How do you feel about me? Now that you know that I realize that I'm one of the superior people of the world, don't you think that I'm pretty smart for being so perceptive? Yes, I'm flattering you. You remember the fact that people respond to flattery in another truism? However, I also have some power over you. Now that I have your respect, I'd like you to visit one of my websites. Better yet, why not to Amazon.com? Go to Amazon.com and order my latest book. You, as a leader in your world today, can appreciate the importance of reading even the most controversial material. It's a superior thing to do, and the only superior people will go to do it right now. People are deeply affected by what others think. See, people are deeply affected by what other people think. Other people think of what others think. Most people can't decide to do something on their own. They need to know what is the rest of the world thinks. So sell, convince any of these of anything, deliver a long term of endorsements, testimonials from people who have experienced real results from the same token. Keep the service and quality top notch. People will talk to us about behind our backs. Unless you or the word is impeccable, the word will get out and it's to be avoided. Again, people won't decide totally alone if you have the valuable or not. But what they'll do is look for their friends or families or coworkers or peers to tell them what to think. How people to think. Help people to think about you to the way you want them to think about you by giving them quotes from people that make you look good, because people are deeply affected by what others think. People only act to self-serving reasons, no matter what they say or what they think, that people only act for self-serving reasons. Everyone disagrees with this truism, but still it's true that no one does anything without a secret desire to benefit from it from which they are doing. Even the most altruistic among the behavior is the way of what makes them feel better. If you want to sell more of anything, tie your goods from which people want. People will donate your money to you to cause for an example. If you give them something with their names on it, people will buy the product or service and it'll stoke to their ego. Even subtle, face it. You don't do it, it gave money and didn't get anything in return. Baloney. You felt better or you wouldn't have done it. Feeling better was your payoff. Again, play to people's egos and you can win friends and get rich. People unconsciously respond to your unconscious attentions. People unconsciously respond to your unconscious intentions. This is a principle from my book, The Attractor Factor. It means that your unconscious desires affect people in a way you train people to respond to you from what you say and don't say, and from the ways you phone with the Bob Proctor, he said. Your energy goes out and touches the person that you are talking and feeling while you're talking to them. That means that this is what you have, a self-sabotaging desire in you, or you are trying to pull a fast one on people. If you don't believe that your own business and prospects will sense it, they will respond to your unconsciousness. If you want to get more business, get clear. Be congruent. Be sure you totally believe even yourself, your business, and your customers' goodwill. Because people unconsciously respond to your unconsciousness intentions. People will never change their human emotions or basic desires. Only their dress and their tools will change. People throughout time have been motivated by the same desires and emotions. The top three goals of everyone alive are food, love, and money. They were the same in the 1700s. They'll be the same in the 2700s. What people are accustomed to technology, humans and remain human, appear in their basic self-interest. Help them achieve food, love, and money, for example, and they will help you get at least one of your goals, too. Proper usage, defining your life's purpose. You can have whatever you want as long as you don't want it. You'll learn in life that needing is an addiction that pushes away whatever you want. As long as you want something without needing it, you can have it. As soon as you need it, you send out a signal that will push it away. This is an advanced concept, so don't get a head cramp if it doesn't make sense just yet. But you can have whatever you want as long as you don't want it. Rags to rags. Rags to rages. Mark Joyner. When I was young, punk rocker in Reno, Nevada, one of my heroes was a local legend by the name of Tony Hospital. We called him Hospital because his crazy skateboarding and surfing antics always had him in and out of one. One day he came out to my house, got a haircut. Cutting punk rock hair was not so hard. We did it all for each other often. He asked me to shave the word rage into his head and inadvertently ran out of space so it said rag. For a brief moment, I thought Tony would kick my ass. Then this man truly had zero fear, so I hesitantly handed him the mirror. He looked at it and said, rag, cool, rag. Got up, picked up my skateboard, and started skating in front of my house. He had no fear, but he wasn't a cool man. He had a big heart, and he was in love with life. He was in love with life. Other people would have been angry or embarrassed, but Tony simply turned into something good, got up, and skated on. The moment always affected me deeply. Never have I been able to be so unaffected internally or unstoppable, but I've strived for it every day of my life. Later on, I discovered that Tony had become addicted to shooting heroin, and he got his girlfriend hooked on it as well, and she eventually OD'd and died. And 1 year's anniversary of her death, Tony took his own life. I used to think that simply living as impassion of letting nothing affect you was the key to life, but it seems that Tony took it too far, or perhaps to the wrong place. At this point, I attempted to wax philosophical about how my passions can just be easily fused to destruction as well as my creation. I could refer to the golden means and preach to you in balance, but what all this is another is the self-indulgent prattle. I won't pretend to understand how or what this happened or how this happened to him. What's important for your life is how that it did and nothing more. Mark Joyner is an internet celebrity, a best-selling author. His latest book is The Irresistible Offer. See www.mrfire.simpleology.com. Simpleology.com. Crazy Wisdom, Blair Warren. First, realize that no one has ever done a great thing. Not a written great novel, great painting that's ever cooked a great meal. Anything we do, if this is ever to be deemed great, must be deemed great after the fact, not during the creation itself. Furthermore, other people, not creators themselves, bestow the label great. But, and what I mean is this, is that it is tempting to think that people who have created great works, art, knew what they were doing was so that their experience of the creation was going to be dramatically different than their own. The truth is that Hemingway simply put words in the hamper, words of the paper, one after another, that just like the rest of us, Michelangelo put paint down, stroke at a time, one stroke at a time, just like the rest of us. Their works only became great as in which they were finished and other people deemed them great. This is a very freeing thought for me. See, when I'm frustrated with the way I'm writing or going, I remind myself that even the great writers went through what I'm going through, and it encourages me just to go on. My second idea is this. It is critical to understand the difference between an illusion from one who makes the illusion. For example, when I was a kid, I worshipped the rock star Gene Simmons of Kiss. I wanted to be just like him. I did everything I could just to make it happen. The trouble was, is I was emulating an illusion. It turns out that Gene Simmons wasn't a blood-spinning, fire-breathing rebel I saw on stage. That was all an act. It was only years later that I learned the truth, that he was an educated conservative man who never touched drugs or alcohol in his life. I felt like such an idiot, but I was only 13 at the time and I believed everything I saw, and I shudder to think how differently my life may have turned out. Just from the truth of emulating the vision makes it not the illusion. Now, I had learned that, shudder to think the difference of my life of how it turned out had I known the truth and emulated the illusion maker and not the illusion. Blair Warren is a TV producer and author. See www.blairwarren.com. Be who you are, honestly, truthfully, and entirely. There is no one who can be you better. 14-year-old Harmony McCormick Whitrin. Growing old may be a choice. Many scientists have baffled the new and no idea why we age, considering that our bodies are constantly regenerating themselves. So then, why do we age? Bad diet, poor health, choices, drinking, smoking, etc., stress, deep-rooted beliefs, programming the age as normal from the biggest factor of all, the baggage from which we drag, from which everything is made, makes us old. Aging may make it unnecessarily, and it should be classified as being a disease rather than something that is a normal part of life. This isn't going to be easy to accept because the majority of the world looks around, sees people aging and dying, and assumes that this is the way it is. But that's not normal. Money is energy. Money is neutral. In life, you will find that people with the will die for it, kill for it, but in the end, we went after something that is, in itself, meaningless. Money is an innocent means of exchange. It replaces trading tomatoes for shoes. It simplifies the bartering process. Money is energy and means nothing. What you do with money and why you want it are what counts. Marketing is not evil. Marketing is not evil. Yesterday, I met a rancher who also raises buffalo and sells bison products. He gushes facts. He gushed facts, for example. I didn't know buffalo never get cancer, or the buffalo meat is leaner, healthier, and better for any other red meat. I also know that the buffalo contains fewer calories than even chicken. Most people just don't know how to cook it. The rancher explained, since the meat is clean, it needs to be slowly cooked in a really slow, low flame. He went on to add, people on the paleo diet, sometimes called the caveman diet, really love it. It helps them lose weight and get trimmed naturally, he said. I eat 1 or 2 pounds of bison every day, some veggies, and I'm fit and strong. And I was taken by this information, and I placed a large order on the spot. But the rancher also had some opinions from which made me curious. I'm just a rancher, he told me. I run my ranch all by myself, and I work at night and day, and yet at the end of it all, I have to go out and market this stuff. I'm almost hating it. You hate marketing? I asked. I just saw the actor Billy Bob Thornton on the television and said, marketing is evil. That's interesting, I countered. The reason Thornton is on the television is because he is marketing the latest movie he's in. Well, I don't like marketing, the rancher told me. Maybe it's because I don't know how to do it. At this point, Nerissa came out and met the rancher too. He offered her a sample of the buffalo jerky he made. He went out in front of her and said, "You'll eat this and you won't want anything else for the rest of the day. This is the most filling and satisfying food you will ever have," he said. "There's no preservatives and it's all natural." Of course, at that point, I wanted to say jerky too. When the rancher went to write up under the order, he pulled out his truck, a beautiful notebook. He showed her to place it on the hood of the BMW Z3 sports car when I stopped him. "I don't want it scratched," I said. "Look at this," he said. "Rubber, the leather on the notebook. Go ahead and touch it and see how smooth it is." I did. The leather was melted butter soft. The rancher then asked me something hypnotic. "Can you imagine walking into a meeting with someone with one of these under your arms?" Of course, the question activated a visual part of my brain and engaged my ego. I instantly wanted to unusual product. "How can I get one of those?" I asked. "I can have one made for you as if you want. I ordered one of the Buffalo notebooks too." I then paid to the rancher, shook his hand, and he got into his truck. Still muttering from which he didn't like marketing, he said that he was still behind his learning marketing, that he had prehistoricness in his practices. "Guess that you're doing paleo marketing," I offered. He laughed and drove off. He didn't seem to notice that his non-marketing made a lot of sales that day. I bought meat, jerky, and a notebook. I also bought a case of honey, from which I forgot to mention. None of it was cheap either. I said it before and I'll say it again. Marketing is simply engaging information, informing the people most likely to be interested in the product or service that is available. Marketing is simply engaging, informing the people most likely to be interested in your product or service that is available. Simply engaging and informing the people. This is what I teach people in my executive mentoring program. I'll repeat it. Marketing is simply engagingly informing the people most likely to be interested in your product or service that is available. It's not about manipulation. It's not about information. The more passionately and sincere you convey your information, the more hypnotic your marketing will be. But if you try to market your business to someone who has no interest in it, you may be considered evil. The rancher was in a marketing thought. He admitted, for his love for the product was apparent. He eats buffalo, wears buffalo, raises buffalo, talks buffalo. He doesn't talk bull. He talks buffalo. And when he talks, the people listen and they're interested in bison and then they buy. Marketing is only evil when you lie and you mislead people from which you make a sale. And then the message isn't appropriate for the audience that you've reached. No one should ever do that, ever. There's no excuse for it. But if you're offering a product for service and you believe in it, then share the excitement for that and the right of the audience. If you don't believe in it, your product or services, then what are you doing trying to sell it? Said another way, if you have something from which you truly benefit a certain group of people, for which you don't tell them, then you aren't even doing them aren't you doing them a disservice? If you have something that's really cool for a certain set of people and you don't tell them, again, marketing is basically sharing your love, your passion, and your belief. When you share it with someone who welcomes it, more often than not, it leads to a sale, naturally, easily, effortlessly, and there is no BS. Failure is not death. I'm a famous businessman, once said, and I'm 74 years of old, a millionaire now, and I've tried a lot of things, and I've failed a lot, and there's things to get me here. Now, here's what I learned about failure. Nothing bad ever happens to you. Nothing bad ever happens to you. There it is. It's the secret to handling failure, is that nothing bad ever happens to you. You go on to the next thing, don't you? Think about it. Every time you fail, nothing bad happens to you, and you just go on to the next thing. You don't give up. You take a deep breath. You dust yourself off. You learn. And then you do the next thing. Failure is not death. How to handle death. If you're the one who died, you don't need this section. If you lost someone close to you, rejoice that you've just moved on. They've moved on to their next adventure. And it's okay to miss them. It's okay to cry. Grieving is part of a life experience. It will last as long as it lasts, but you're still okay. The only thing that you can count on, we just got back up to the trip of Houston, where we attended a memorial service for my ex-wife and best friend of 27 years, Marion, and stormed the entire three-hour drive there. The city was flooded and the sky dark, clouds dumping with the rain, and the streets crowded and dangerous, yet few dozen people weathered in storms attending the service. Some people I hadn't even seen in 15 years. Some I've known for 30 years. Some I've never even met before. Every day I look out for the good of every moment, and it may not be easy at first, but you can do it too. For example, a friend called me the other day and said, "How was I handling the loss?" We spoke for a while and we shared our own feelings and sadness. He told me that it's real easy to fall into a negative thinking. I agreed, and then I thought about it and realized that I wasn't falling into negative thinking. I'm just grieving. I'm sad. I'm at the times barely able to function, but I'm not thinking negatively. Along the way in my life with the Marion, I've learned that it's all good. Even the grieving, even death, it's all good. When we woke back from the Houston day, traffic suddenly stopped. We didn't even know what happened. We saw a helicopter and knew someone badly was hurt, being carried to an hospital. As traffic moved again, and we were able to see the terrible wreck that had taken place. Moments before what happened, the driver was talking, laughing, maybe planning their evening. Now they're hurt, possibly dead. You never know from moment to moment which one is going to be our last. I suggest that you live now. I suggest the opportunities come from a way that you grab them. I suggest that you do more smiling, hugging, sharing, crying, laughing, risking, and forgiving. I suggest that you monitor your thoughts. Notice your negative ones and consciously replace them with positive ones. Yes, I know it can be difficult at first, and I've learned from the Mental Toughness Institute program that I am in that your thoughts can be elevated and you can rise above negative thinking. You can simply have to retain your brain. All you have to do is have the power to do it. You just might need someone to support you to make your new habit. Well, Marion pointed the way. She said, it's all good. This is the one and only moment of your life. This is the only moment that you can count on. This is it, and it's all good. The healer's secret. How the secret transforms your relationships. The healer's secret. How can the secret transform your relationships? William Whitman. My mother introduced me to one of the most powerful mysteries as the healer can be given. It is, in fact, the secret that underlines my healing work. Although this mystery has revealed to me at age 8, it continues to deepen over the decades. Travel block. Travel back with me to the mid-1950s World War II, still influencing everything. My parents and all my friends' parents been involved in the war. Their generation called it the war for the remainder of their lives. John Wayne's war movies were all non-spies from the black and white TVs, guns, and were all part of the fabric of that life. War was still good. My first bank account was in Sandy Springs, Maryland. Quakers owned, they operated the bank. Behind the bank was the Quaker meeting house where my mother and her family attended, and there was sometimes an obliged to go. Once a summer, we underwent an ordeal of having to attend. Now to the meat. Mom and I asked, how come the bank's guards don't carry guns? I imagined reality containing gops and robbers, and I'd noticed that this parody. I was concerned for my life's safety, which was real on the deposit. After pausing a beat, she honored me with a real answer. Well, Quakers believe that there is that of Christ in everyone, and I got it. It is amazing that these words penetrate my Indian-killing, Alamo-defending, Davy Crockett-infused brain. I understood. If you could think the other guy has Christ in them, you don't have to. You don't want to shoot them because you don't want to shoot Christ. This has all made exquisite sense to me, and there is that of Christ in everyone. Margaret Whitman, Mom. In ecumenical pause, when I was raised in the Christian traditions, I was comfortable with them, and I went and wanted to assure that I found all the principles in this chapter of many other traditions from which they are either original nor unique to Christianity. I prefer not to use Christian terminology with my clients because most of them have too many fuzzy doctrines lying their own minds of gathering for the years of exposure. Most of my patients are not Buddhist, so I use the language because of the unburden of my personal history. I haven't met anyone with a negative Buddhist prejudice. Buddhist terminology is fresh for most clients. Here's another truth I wish that I had learned earlier. Enlightened teachings of all traditions say the same thing. Enlightened teachers of all traditions say same things. How is there is that of Christ is in everyone useful? Well, most doctors think that people is in the complaint of the condition of the disease. It's easy to fall into this trap. We humans like to categorize and label. The kidney patient in room 305. The manic depressive patient I saw yesterday. Oh, the old woman in my office. As a healer, the minute I got connected, I got conned into thinking that people as their disease or their condition. I lose my effectiveness. If I fall for their presenting symptoms and believe into their problems, all possibilities for healings will disappear. They are doomed to live in the life of the path of their disease and their condition. As a healer, I work to see that of Christ in my patients. I say work because sometimes my patients see such an engaging stories that I had caught up in the story that I even tempted to rescue them. However, when I remember that there is Christ or Buddha or beings in the white light, there is no rescue to require. And then I bring my 30-plus years skills to bear the problems at hand to help support the wanderer's being inside. No worries. As our Australian friend says, we don't discard our worldly skills. We harness them to these insights. These are the harnesses, insights to the skills from which work becomes much easier with the possibility of staggering breakthroughs. Potent healing idea. Go into cahoots. I serve my patients best when I go into cahoots with the Christ of them to work on their problems. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. Matthew 18:20. For where there are two or three gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. This teaching builds you on your knowing that there is that of Christ in everyone. When we align ourselves with that profound spiritual nature, miracles can occur. Christ is in everybody. Imagine how confident that you would be if you in your work in the alignment of the sacred possibilities occur that you would not occur when you would look at the natural disease prognosis. So, the Christ is me that gives me the cahoots of the Christ in them. Healing happens, possibilities to unfold, and the world changes. When I touch patients during my hands on the work, I contact the sacred and the ancestor of the ancient wisdom in them. The wisdom knows how to heal. I just listen and follow the directions. I would like them to know the implications of this in a deeper level than much of my earlier times, but I won't complain. I may take a lifetime to unfold this kind of wisdom, seeing that of Christ in people who have been there in the core of my success with patients and students for years. But, William, I am not a healer. How does this help me? Well, first of all, we are all healers and teachers, right? Let us put that aside. You are in the relationships with other peoples all day. When you apply the insights that is Christ in everyone to your relationships, they will then be transformed magnificently. Imagine that you would be in the life of some people that you life were enlightened beings, and you would be, and how would the life look like? Clerks in stores become saints, servers in restaurants become holy teachers, and your loved ones become magical. The power of expectations. What would happen if you expected everyone that you know to those to come in contact with you to be enlightened, that if you held them a standard of excellence, that you held all of your friends at a standard of excellence, that the evidence and studies with children and teachers is clear. If you take a class of average students and teach the teachers and the same exceptional bright kids with the high IQs and the students perform better, and their scores on an IQ test at the end of the years go up, the opposite also happens. For expectations affected that we get in the world, expect enlightenment souls you love and live in heaven. No kidding. This is good for the world that we live in. You may be so blessed. William Whitman is a body therapist. See www.vitalarts.net. Three Secrets, Mark Gitterl, MD. Three secrets. Faith is essential to prayer, and we have all heard the axiom of some form or the other. In fact, we might all recall the parable about prayer. All it takes is a mustard seed. What most of us forget is the second half is a parable, is paraphrased. Therefore, pray that you will have the mustard seed of faith. Huh? Let me sum it up. It doesn't take much faith to succeed at a prayer, but you probably don't have even but a little bit. Wow, you may be thinking, nobody ever told me that. I thought that all we had at least was a tiny mustard seed of faith. And fact is that in my experience, most of us don't even have enough faith. I'll venture to bet that you can never be connected with the fact before that you can even embrace it now. Your life will never be the same, for the few of us discover faith. This is the life-remaking secret. It is the one that can lay hidden in the plain sight, and you'll fill in of your will for a lifetime. It's your faith. Your faith. How is your faith? What is your faith? What is and why is your faith? You can access the truth right now. Pray for a mustard seed of faith to begin growing inside of you. Pray that faith will quickly grow inside of you and flourish so that your prayers will be empowered and become effective. You will now feel any indifferent. You will now be in possession of something invisible and awesomely powerful right now. Something from now can take control of you. Something will now grow inside of you. Before long, you will become obvious to everyone to know that something is different. I'm not talking about religious concepts. Faith has nothing to do with religion. Religion is co-opted faith. Now, which is here of nothing as long before? Now that you have prayed for faith, it is time to embrace the second secret of prayer. Most of the people are embarrassing tiny things. Why? To create a power of the universe in which listening to your prayers, all of life has been ready to make sweeping dramatic changes to bless you and to those whom you care for. However, to make universally prayer for a minuscule thing such as slightly better job or marriage becomes a little better, people that prayed for their marriages would be bearable to make a little more than money. Instead of, why not pray brashly? I have it in good authority that this is way and this is the way to do it. You can start right now. I suggest that you pray for an income to increase dramatically and go ahead and I recommend it. And then not to pray for your relationships to be amazing? That's just not okay. Pray for a rich detail for gems like this. I pray that it'll be incredible husband for a wife, delighting my spouse with the romance, strength, and solace in the deep, sweet friendship. If you're not married and you want to be, pray that you'll be in a romantic storybook intensity and that you will lead to an enduring marriage full of more romance, happiness, mutual personal growth, and adventure. Why not transform your workplace? How about praying that you'll be blessed immensely from the people that you work with and the delight of working with them, and you'll be a catalyst in creativity, wisdom, and that will help you in the light of the work. We'll pray it'll help you work with incredible enlightened company from which you push the envelope for positive, dramatic change in their sphere of business. The theme is obvious and just as easy to create of a force that creates a universe and creates in each instant to do and great wonderful things to respond from which your own prayers to do minuscule things. Prayer is the creative partnership between the will of vision and creative power and the designer of the universe. You are truly called, I believe, to co-create in every area of your life as Joe Vitale, the Audi Liquid Dignium, dares something worthy. Well, I'm suggesting that every day you dare something great in prayer. Why not? In fact, every time you see something that underwhelms you in any way, but be in the mirror of across the room or on the news, why not pray for it to be transformed into something great. Pray for something great. Now here's another secret that will truly empower you for your prayers. After you know what you want in your prayer in your head, set it with feeling from your heart center, right in the middle of your chest. That's where the prayer comes from. Now, from your head. Now your possession is one of the most closely guarded secrets of your life. Yes, real prayers are formulated in the mind and sent from the heart. It is a beautiful partnership and it works. And the way we make this function, try it right now. You will have the difference between the old ways of doing things immediately. In fact, from soon experience something really amazing. You'll simply know that your prayer has been answered immediately end of prayer as it's being sent off by your heart. This doesn't mean that you will send the answer or feel the answer immediately. Rather, that you have a sense of knowing that it will become a reality. And the rest is just a bit of time in watching details unfold. Finally, I will present the third secret, from which combined with the others, you will lead to into such a revolutionary change that you have a smiling, have you smiling for years, from which you know and you look back at life, changing by the prayer so dramatically that your virtual is you're virtually unrecognizable. The secret of this is when you send off a prayer, let it go. Smile, sigh, sigh of release, and just let it go. Let it fly to heaven like a small bird in graceful wings. Graceful wings. If you continue to feel the sense of unease in your chest as though you have not to let it go, you haven't let it go. Like a bird tethered to its perch, the prayer cannot be sent or reach heaven if the heart is holding on to it. Now let it go. Let it soar. Smile and let it soar. In additional secrets, because you are in a direct contact with the designer of the universe, why not pray often for the most precious things of all, namely that you have continually transformed fully into a truly wise, truly loving, truly great human being who spends joy, faith, hope, and love contagiously. This is some corny sentiment. This is the real deal. This is not just possibility. This would be the living reality in which simply dare to pray for these truly great things. However, we are here to live, all of us, life. So don't think of a minute that you don't have to be praying for any good thing that you really want, but be the really amazing car, beautiful relationships, house, or a beach in Maui. Prayer for anything that is clear, from which you in active and engaging intimacy of dynamically with the creator, with the creator of these great things. It is an act of acknowledgement that the creative power from which you love that you brought yourself into this being. As I look back of more and more the decades of my life since I began my adventure of applying these incredible secrets, I see revolution in every area. Marriage, career, friendship, creativity, leisure, learning, virtually from the time I get up in the morning until I go to sleep at night, I'm surrounded by often improbable, astonishing, amazing answered prayers. Dr. Mark Gitterl, co-author of the forthcoming book, No Effort Healing. Assembly Required, Creating Your Future. Almost all first steps are awkward. You may not remember, but your first steps were awkward. You fell down a lot. You probably bumped your head. You may have scraped your knee, but you got up. You learned to walk. You learned to run. You've been here before, and you made it to here. Well done. The same way you learn to walk is how you're going to learn to do anything. Take some stabs at it, walk a little, wobble, fall down, get up again. That's the real secret. Get up again. As long as you can get up again, you're never out of life. Don't fall back. Bill Hibbler. I've been an entrepreneur for as long as I can remember. When I was a kid, I sold newspaper subscriptions and even toothbrushes door to door. Later, I had a paper route. When I got interested in rock and roll, I started creating music business. The music business at age 15, I rented out a sound system for special events, selling vintage guitars to all big bands that came through Houston. At the time, I didn't care about much about making money, but loved getting backstage to meet my favorite rock stars. I worked with everyone from Aerosmith, Chuck Berry, Muddy Waters to ZZ Top. Name the band, I probably sold them a guitar or some gear. While backstage, I'd watch the roadies set up and tearing down the gear, doing all the little things to move a rock band from city to city. I knew exactly what I wanted to be in when I grew up. The rock stars were fun to watch on stage, but not necessarily impressive off stage. The person that impressed me the most was the road manager. The road manager ran the show. He was responsible for making sure everyone is where they were supposed to be when they were supposed to be there. And if there was a problem, he solved it. Good road manager runs things tight in a military operation. And what a lifestyle. The road manager could wear his hair long as he wanted and can dress in jeans, t-shirts, leather jacket is optional. And to get more girls, even in a band did. And all you'd imagine, this appealed to me. Your parents didn't share much of the enthusiasm. In fact, they were horrified. If ever it occurred to them, my building business relationships with the rock stars at such as a young age showed me potential for success in music. You need to go to college, they told me. I told them they didn't teach me how to be a road manager in college. You need to go and get your degree first, and then you could still want to go and do your rock and roll thing. That way you have something to fall back on. Well, would you believe it? I listened to them, and in fall of 1977, I enrolled in the University of Houston as an accounting major. 6 weeks later, I dropped out. College was not for me. Back then were there no books to being a road manager, and I really needed a mentor, but then I had no idea how to find one. This was way back in the days before voicemail, cell phones, and mail. I did meet road managers, but finally usually too busy to stop to and talk for any length of time. Because of their attitude towards the music business, I couldn't talk to my parents. If I voiced doubts about what I was doing or particular situations, they saw as an opportunity to discourage me from continuing. They didn't do much help for my confidence, but were always on and on with you need something to fall back on. And this resulted shut out my life from did the same. I shut them out of my life, and they did the same. We eventually made peace several years later. Despite the lack of support in my ripe old age of 22, I became a road manager of the British band Humble Pie. I toured the United States several times for the next few years until the band broke up and the members returned to England. I wore lots of hats in music biz, touring the world around several times, eventually ended up managing several artists. I retired from the music biz in 1998, and I have since then moved to internet marketing, from which I almost loved. and I almost did the music biz. I almost loved it as much as I did the music business, and although I had some success in music, I always felt a little crippled in the lack of support from my family. Far too often, I heard their voices in my head saying, you need to have something to fall back on. Is there something I've learned today is needing something to fall back on is a load of bull. Having something to fall back on is only guarantees one thing, that you will fall back. It's far better to commit 100% of reaching your goals. In the early 1500s, Spanish explorer Cortez landed on the southeast coast of Mexico. He ordered his men to remove all the sails, metal fittings and cannons from the ships, and he ordered them to burn the ships so there could be no retreat. By burning those ships, Cortez committed himself to 7 men to face the unknown continent, bearing to see the Spain again. He said nothing. They had nothing to fall back on. Did he succeed? Well, there was a reason they speak Spanish in Mexico. If you want to fulfill your dreams, whatever they may be, you've got to be willing to burn your ships, and you've got to be willing to do whatever it takes. If you have children, encourage them to follow their dreams, and even if they aren't exactly what you had in mind for them, and never tell them that they need something to fall back on. Bill Hibbler is the famous internet marketer, www.ecommerceconfidential.com. A new way to easily achieve your goals. I've learned at least 2 things about achieving goals. There's an easy way and a hard way. The hard way is to work nights and days and stay a beast and rarely sleep and never give up. Because everyone talks about the hard ways is always to address the easy way. After all, why struggle if you don't have to? I've used the easy to create a best-selling books of 70 pounds in 8 months, find my ideal mate, get healthy, increase my wealth, and much more. Obviously, it works. Here's the formula in brief. Be grateful for what you already have. Playfully declare what you would like to have with a positive emotion, feeling as if it was already achieved, and act on the nudges and the opportunities that appear. That's it. In my latest book, The Attractor Factor, I explain the 5-step formula for getting what you want. It's useful for those times and you don't need grateful, and you can't decide from what you want, or you don't understand the concept of letting go while taking inspiration. It also is helpful when you have issues about money and deserving, and to feel of any way blocked from any of your goals. However, the bottom line of that for me is this. Declare what you would like to, what you would like with no attachment and plenty of good feeling. Feel grateful for being for what you already have, and act on what appears. The result will be a happy life. Let's explore this in depth again. Be grateful for what you already have. Be grateful for what you already have. Playfully declare from what you would like to have with a positive emotion and feeling as if it's already achieved. Playfully declare what you would like to have with a positive emotion, feelings as if it's already achieved. And act on nudges and opportunities that appear. Act on nudges and opportunities that appear. Now let's explore this in depth. Feel grateful now. It doesn't matter where you live or what you have. If you're reading this, you're most likely living in the kind of queen compared to people in the third world countries. You may even be living better than kings and queens from history, often lived in the cold, violent, frightful times. You've got it made. Choose what you've wanted with attachment feelings as if it's already achieved. There's magic in saying, I'd love to become the world's first breakdancing rapper, but I won't die if I don't have it, because the world is simply energy taking form. You declare from what you want something to begin to attract to it. However, you need something, you need to push it away. You want to select your desire. Feel the joy of you already having it, without feeling any desperation. Need the push of away. Desire will attract it. If you feel it's already you have your desire, then you will have it. Act on your opportunities and intuitions. You may get offers, calls, or who knows what. Act on them. You'll never know what will lead to your goal. Your ego cannot see the big picture. Intuition and opportunities will come from the larger view. Your job is to act on them. As you do, you will be taken from your goal, even when it appears that you are being blocked from it. Trust is key. It is really all there is to it. Is that really all there is to it? Again, the fuller procedure in the attractor factor will take care of any snags in the process, but the basic process is simple. Let's walk through the 3 steps. Number 1, look around your room. What are you grateful for? Make a list. Get into the authentic feeling of true gratitude. In other words, be happy now. You don't need a reason to be happy. If you want one, find something, anything, and be grateful for it right now. When you're grateful, you are in a mental place which will attract more to be grateful for. Number 2, look around the playground of your mind. What would you like to have, to do, or to be? What would be fun? Write it down as you do. What would you like to have already have now? Pretend you won the lotto. How would you like, and what would you want for yourself or others? What would be fun? The key is a playful non-attachment while experiencing the completion now. Number 3. Now pay attention. As you go about your life, listen to the hunches and act upon them. Pay attention to the opportunities and act on them. You'll never know what you can take in the direction of your goal. Your job is to take inspired action. You may have some work to do in this step, but the work will be from your heart, and it'll take you into the direction of getting your goal. Why not go through the steps right now? Write them down, experience them, and check back in a few weeks and see how you're doing. You may be surprised yourself how easily and quickly your goals are achieved. If you find yourself doubting the process, think negatively in any way, and not enjoying the simplicity of each easy way to attain your goals, then consider learning the 5-step process and the attractor factor. Above all, have fun. Keep smiling, be playful, stay grateful. These are the elements of the new secret of manifesting your goals. Remember the words of the famous song that also perfectly summarizes the new way to achieve your goals. Don't worry, be happy. Spinning the roulette wheel of self-fulfillment, Dr. Rick Barrett, the most precious gem that I could pass on to the others to enrich their lives, can be summed up in a small yet powerful word: service. To pursue a life of giving you to the others, to learn and to grow, appreciate, to become empowered, and to open and receiving greater rewards for your, to ourselves. Serving others is the soul from which food and water is the body. Not only sustains, but also allows us to reach our full potential, experience high levels of performance, and ultimately attain great riches, spiritually and materially. Had I known that if I could satisfy all my needs and be rewarded in this life and potentially in the next, I certainly would have begun in the earliest possible age. Learning proper investment techniques is larger age simply because, and it means your outcome will be limited. However, learning simply invest strategies as a child can create massive finance reward over a lifetime. So too in the servicing, so too the serving of others. How much reward can be attained in simply serving others on a regular basis? I believe it is unlimited. When I was young, I had limited belief of helping others was done by donating money to other people whose jobs was to serve. Monetarily, donations are fine and wonderful, but usually are minimal and never stretch a person. But like exercising, if all you ever do is occasionally, whenever you feel like it, push up or do a sit-up, you will never make an impact, never start producing the results of increased health, weight loss, or improving body. Likely you'll not feel the difference. In other words, it's a weak attempt, and there is no reward. However, if you stretch yourself, work out rigorously with a plan, with regularity, you will see and feel massive change, and you will be recipients of great rewards. Giving and serving is much like this. Yes, a few dollars here and there helps someone, but in a great teardrop in the ocean, it goes unnoticed and creates no change. Giving a large sum of money with a regularity will make a change. Certainly, rewards with it brought your way, but it really stretches your soul to expand goodness, to open yourself to a more abundance. There's no substitute for personal service involvement. Most people, including myself, develop in an inward focused mind posture. This mind posture sets up to believe that life is all about ourselves, from which we have to risk to suck out anyone or anything that we want in this planet to offer. This is very opposite to thinking of some groups like Native Americans, who believe that we are all part of the earth, the sky, the animals, and we must only use what we absolutely need. Don't waste and don't overindulge. It is the difference between being selfish and selfless. The truth is, life isn't all about selfishness. It's about others. Everything I desire and need can be in mine, and I choose to focus on giving it to others. I become a servant of others, allowed to grow potentially, exponentially in every area of our lives. If I believe into the future, spiritual lives. Certainly, it's normal to desire and strive to have it accumulate certain things in our lives. But by focusing all the energy inwardly on oneself with the idea of getting as much as you can and maybe giving a little bit away is not selfish but limiting, not only to others but to ourselves. Unfortunately, it seems to be the norm of our society. What should be the norm to believe is to be better course in action to helping others achieve their goals as much as you can and keeping a little for ourselves. By the mechanism, many benefit, and the greater the good is done for others, you can return in the multiplied of many times over. I am sure that you have seen pictures of both explosions and implosions. An implosion directs its energy inwardly. The videos of a building being imploded are magnificent. The charges go off and the whole building crumbles inwardly to a ground in a rather tight circumference of debris, but an explosion like an atomic blast forces its energy inward, creating massive destruction over great distances. Both an implosion and explosion are destructive forces, but take the idea of it and think of a positive explosion of an energy. What would you rather be? An explosive positive energy force that affects untold numbers of people, who include you and the planet, of a small implosion device with a limited impact? Personally, I want to be an explosive and do more, not only for my family and myself, but to make the biggest impact on the planet of the human being as a human being that I possibly can make. This can be done, maintaining a focus on service and outward attentions to others. This is what needs to be done as part of a guidebook from which given birth and taught to implement as soon as we have the ability to understand it. It's to service and give to other people. Envision at the end of your life. Envision the end of your life. If you had your opportunity before you and you died, reflect upon your life. Would the reflection be beautiful and abundant, the world to be ugly and desolate? The question is how will you be judged by ourselves, humanity, and God? How do you want to be remembered? How does a possible positive substantial difference in people's lives? Did we make a positive substantial difference in people's lives, or did we squander our lives and ignore opportunities to help humanity? Of course, we all tend to believe that we'll live long lives with plenty of time to accomplish what we want, but in reality, we can be quite different. Life's least human tangible form is truly fleeting. We aren't privileged to know how much time we have on this planet. The roulette wheel of life spins, and the ball lands on different numbers for all of us, and we are unable to know which number it will be or to influence it. For one person, it might be 101, another 25, and yet another 10. Knowing then the actual number of our days is absolute certainly, and the number shouldn't we act in the best intentions for the greatest good on a daily basis. Each and every day builds and lasts until the last the day is reached, and it seems that I'm reminded of this almost on a daily basis. Is this past weekend, I encountered death twice. The first time from a phone call Saturday from my patient who informed her husband passed away, who was also my patient, one that I've been blessed to have in patients for over the 10 years, World War II and Korean War veteran who had lost his battle to cancer. He was 81 years old. I attended his funeral on Monday. The second encounter occurred as my wife, I was driving home Sunday evening in hills outside Texas. We happened to look upon a scene, an accident. We didn't see the accident, but we couldn't have been more than 20 seconds behind the impact as a few cars each side road were still pulling into the shoulders. As I stopped by the vehicle, rushed to lend an assistance, a man was bending over the mangled body of a motorcyclist laying in the middle of the road. The scene is too gruesome to describe. As I reached them, the man told me he was a physician and he checked the pulse. The motorcyclist was dead. As I looked to the motorcyclist, it was clear from his head injury that he was, in fact, dead. It was hard to determine his age. He was a young man. I thought, how sad to be gone. He's so young. I hoped I didn't have a wife and children would have gone to be... I hoped he didn't have a wife and children that would have been told of his fate. It was once again a vivid reminder of none of us to know how long his or her residence on this planet will last. The roulette wheel stopped at 81 for my patient. Dan, and much lower number for this poor accident victim. Immediately my thoughts around on how much time I have left myself, and whether I am doing enough, and I'm satisfied with all my accomplishments. Am I leaving this planet at least for some better than when I came in it? And as I write this, I am making plans for a more medical missionary, writing more books to help others, myriads of other things, though I didn't receive the instruction of manuals from when you were a child. It's never too late to start. Reflect on how you can start giving and servicing more. Creating lists. Give your spouse an involved. Get your children involved. Make today the beginning of a new era of serving. And now you can take the grow to great rewards. Serving others like exercise. You can never do enough. A parting gift. May you have in a simple prayer I create from my own book, Healed by Morning. I hope it serves you well. Lord God, you are my creator. I love you. I am part of you, therefore I cannot fail because you cannot fail. I am capable of everything, ultimate health, happiness, and success because I am a part of you and you are completely capable. Every good wish I have, I can have because you wish it for me. I will linger in darkness and doubt. I will not linger in darkness and doubt because the spirit of your light illuminates my way. You are in me and I am one with you. Together we can accomplish miracles. Dr. Rick Barrett, the author of numerous books including The Dare to Break Through the Pain. The top 10 destructive money beliefs. The top 10 destructive money beliefs and how to overcome them. Dan Klatt. If you're not making much money as you'd like, then you're holding on to some negative beliefs in which you yourself, you know how much money you're capable of handling. In this article, we'll go through 10 of the most common and most limiting examples of how people hold themselves back financially. Subscribers to eZine, The Abundant Mind, get a money beliefs quiz from their results. And I've compiled these top 10 destructive money beliefs. How many can you relate to? Number 10, money is not spiritual. It's not the belief that you somehow have more spiritual for having a better life after life, a sacrifice greatly as a time around. This is a belief that you're somehow more spiritual or more likely to have a better afterlife if you sacrifice greatly this time around, or that you'll suffer after you die if you pursue the things you want, which you need money to buy. This belief is most often an effect of people's religious upbringing. Remember that you're here to live life fully right now. You're just here to live life fully right now. Number 9, I'll get it tomorrow. When you're pushing things off, you step off the natural flow and includes allowance abundance to come into your life. It almost is based on fear from which to fail anyway. Influence will disappoint you and delay makes you feel inevitable. Once you start living the moment, though you let go of the grip from which your past held onto you, you realize the new person now, you've learned to grow a lot since the last things that didn't go as planned. And that's only happened because you still had not learned something you needed then to succeed, which you probably know now. Number 8, I'll probably just fail anyway. We probably all heard the wisdom of Wayne Gretzky. You always miss the shot you don't take. When people don't take action, they're just afraid they'll fail. Well, guess what? You're not even trying. They have already failed. They have already succeeded just by moving forward. But you've not achieved your objectives right away, yet you will still have learned some valuable lessons, and that makes it more likely you'll succeed next time. Number 7, but we can't afford that. This kind of thinking comes from scarcity and lack of abundance. It also gets people to focus on what they don't have, which empowers them not having. The feel is that the things they do have or not enough. Instead, when you're appreciating everything you do have comes from the mindset of abundance, you start bringing things you want closer. So you also realize that there's no limit to what you can become, accomplish, or have. Number 6, rich people are greedy and dishonest. The first person to spread the untruth must have been a poor person. The fact is that most people who become wealthy or at least somewhat aware of the spiritual principles allowed them to prosper. A key part of this is to stay flow, which means giving back. Rich people are almost amongst the most generous too. They also started the habits of giving long before they started having a lot of money. Coincidence? Not a chance. Number 5, If I'm successful with my friends, will be jealous and stop liking me. Remember that we live in an abundant universe. There is enough for everybody. People who envy others are just coming up in scarcity. They're actually harmful influence of your abundant mind and actually critical to your experience of prosperity and only allow positive, supportive, inspiration messages into your brain. And that especially includes your own thoughts. Number four, I'm no better than my parents, so I shouldn't make more than they did. The world is much different than when your parents were where you're at. Tools like the internet have made it possible for everyone to make lots of money doing what they love. Besides your parents, they've struggled precisely to give you a better life than they had. They loved you and they would want it in no other way. Number three, I might forget what's truly important and not like the person I've become. People who are greedy still become the scarcity of lack and they made lots of money but not to enjoy it any more likely to lose it. Instead, you come from a mindset of abundance. Know your encompass. Far more than material health. In fact, it requires a balance between great health, meaningful relationships, ample time, relaxation, playing, and truly enjoying your financial abundance. You will have the abundance of happiness when you come from an abundant mind. Number two, money is the root of all evil. This is the most common error we learn from our parents or religious institutions and keeps millions in poverty and enslaved to money. That's, by the way, the only way from which we could judge money as evil. When it controls us, only happens if we feel that we need it because coming of scarcity and lack. When you come from abundance, money comes as a tool to enjoy the finer things of life, gives you everything you need to fulfill your life's purpose. And that's why we're here, right? To fill our life's purpose. Number one is I'm not worthy. Do you realize that fully 90% of the population has an issue of low self-esteem? It's the number of this that holds people back and prevents them from living their dreams. People from which they don't get to deserve the wealth and abundance in any area and to take opportunities that they're given. Instead, they do nothing and complain about it with others when others become abundant. And also to make up lots of excuses and justify why life has done them wrong. Instead, please realize that the abundant mind is what separates the richest person from the crowd. And you could choose right now to come abundant from come from abundance and take your place amongst the wealthy, and you are worthy. Dan Clatt, creator of Inner Wealth Mystery Program through http://tinyurl.com. Your mind is an instrument for poverty or prosperity. Randy Gage. This is either the scariest thing you will ever hear or the most liberating insight you will ever learn. Make it the latter, and you are well on your way to abundance. No two people ever view the same event in the same way, where one may see a threat, others see opportunity. Suppose you were offered a chance to participate in this opportunity. You could approach this in a number of different ways. You could jump blindly without doing any research just because you enamored in the idea of getting rich. This could bring you to a very bad situation and you can lose a lot of money. Or scenario two, you could figure an ideal to find out a way you're already find out about it is already too late, and you could think of the insiders to get all the sweetheart deals, probably too much, too good to be true, so you pass up the chance to buy IBM when it was $10 a share. Another scenario might occur when you get offered a situation, you have confidence in yourself and study it thoroughly, and you make a second decision. How you react to the opportunity is determined almost entirely by your mindset, which reflects from what you expect from life. All the tools you can use to manifest your prosperity, your mind, and the mind is the most powerful. Randy Gage, the author of the best-selling albums Dynamic Development and Prosperity, the director of www.breakthroughyou.com. When bad things happen to good people, what looks horrible in the moment usually looks good a few years from now. I remember reading a helpful passage from one of my favorite books, Breaking Through the Rules by Kurt Wright, and it goes like this. Have you ever noticed how easy it is to look back at the events that happened a year or more or past and see the perfection in them? The most of this is true for the situations which seem tragic, horrible, or even devastating at the time. Now it's possible to see the perfection of those things a year later. Doesn't it make sense that a perfection must be there in the moment it happens to? With that in mind, see if you can get some positive perspective on any bad event right now. Ask yourself, what are some positive things that you could come from this event? Cancer survivor Lance Armstrong ended up saying that cancer was the best thing that ever happened to him. Without it, he said, he would never have been motivated to win the Tour de France. Look for the good and the bad. It's there. Everything you do will be a success. Everything you do will be a success. You won't think so times because you'll compare it to reality of what happens to the goals you intended to happen. For example, if you want to lose 15 pounds in just 10, you'll catch that as a failure, but they're actually succeeding of losing 10 pounds. If you tried to start a business and made $10 and lost $10,000, you'll call it a failure. However, you learned what you should do and what you should not do, so you had a successful education, and you made 10 bucks to boot. Well, you may always desire to achieve your goals you stated. Always remind yourself that whatever the outcome, you succeeded in some way. Life is Short. Life is Short by Jillian Coleman. Like everybody else, I got a lot of advice growing up. I got it from my parents, my grandparents. I got it from priests, nuns, church, grammar school, high school, and Catholic university. I got it from thousands of books I've devoured and hundreds of movies. I got it from radio serials, listening to every week like Sergeant Peston in the Yukon, The Lone Ranger. I got it from TV, Howdy Doody, Sky King, and Roy Rogers. A lot of it was helpful, and a lot of it was worse than useless. The older I get, the more I seem to return to the basics. My mother was right. Sugar isn't good for you. My grandfather was right. It's important to save your money, and the nuns were right. Life is happy when you forgive those who've hurt me, and monogamy works better than sleeping around. Of all the advice I've ever received, the one counsel that most influences my life, the one I really took to my heart and accepted as a guide, came from my father. He said, "Life is too short not to do what you want." Well, that's what he said, and when I was younger later on, I often heard the uncensored, R-rated version of "Life is too short to let anybody jerk you around." It was hard living with my father when I was a kid. He'd been in the war and made it him a little crazy. He was brilliant and charming, but also violent and unpredictable, and we were a little more sadistic. And a complicated man who took a long time sorting himself out. Spent a lot of years sorting out myself as a result, but that's another story, as they say. My father didn't accept many of the conventional values that he strongly held values nevertheless. Loyalty was especially family loyalty. Intellectual curiosity was another. His most cherished value, however, was commitment to his personal freedom. He lived life absolutely on his own terms. My terms are different than my dad's. I've made different choices and established different priorities. However, I've consistently lived my life to please myself. I've done what I wanted to do. My dad's advice has empowered me to work for myself. It has allowed me to walk away from my unhappy marriages, even though from my father himself, to give me some grief over my decision. It has given me the strength to turn back on false friends and to stand up to authority. It's enabled me to question my doctors as to taking me into the streets to protest racism and wars. It has then encouraged me to live my life without courage, appetite, and adventure. Today, I sometimes refer to myself as a middle-aged, but recently a friend teasingly pointed out to me a few people lived 120. I'm probably closer to the last third of my life than the last half. In many ways, I am mellowed over the last 20 to 30 years. My father's advice still rings in my mind, and however long I have left, I plan to live with this as my guide. Life is too short not to do what you want. Jillian Coleman Wheeler in the Grants of Business Consultants and Business and Nonprofit Organizations. Her website, www.grantmerich.com, is a source site for entrepreneurs, grant writers, consultants, and other online trainings for grants consultants. She's an author of The New American Land Rush, How to Buy Real Estate with Government Money. The Owner's Manual I Wish I Had Gotten at Birth, Pat O'Brien. As soon as you're born, they make you feel small by giving you no time instead of it all, John Lennon. As soon as you're born, they make you feel small by giving you no time instead of it all. When I think of what I wish I had been told at birth, the answer is nothing. The people doing the telling were doing their best, I guess, but they got it all wrong. Everything I was told was wrong. Everything I was told was probably wrong, too. We come into this world with everything we need. We start losing that wisdom as soon as we start listening to our parents, teachers, and the media. Much of our formative years are spent learning the rules of grammar, rules of department, rules of political society, the rules of success and happiness. Only after the years of studying personal destruction have I learned the real truth, the truth about rules. There is no such thing for winners, there aren't any rules. And there ain't rules. For winners, there ain't no rules. Take the rules for success. I don't know about you, but I was told to study hard and do well in school and get a job, and that's the road to success. Well, there's a better way. Why not be successful in the world? I don't know what it could be, and yet parents, teachers, and others, well-meaning people recited the rules for me over and over again. They're still reciting. Go ask Bill Gates. He wants a job. Go ask Steve Jobs. What's the job? Go ask Richard Branson if he wants a job. Go look at the list of most successful people on the planet and see how many of them have jobs. Zero. Zip. Nada. Create businesses. They create jobs. However, the most successful people on the planet have ideas. They don't have jobs. How about education? Again, I can only relate to my personal experiences, but my education has made me highly qualified to sit up at a desk and wrote tasks over and over again. My education would be very useful if my ultimate goal was to have been a 19th century factory worker. I specifically do not want to be a 19th century factory worker. I want to be a 21st century author, marketer, or an entrepreneur. There's the college. Where's the college for that? The college where I got my diploma didn't have a master entrepreneurship diploma. They offered a business degree. I got one. It ain't worth the paper it's printed on, and it's printed on some pretty cheap paper. The college would have been glad to see me in a degree in English, but I could study literature. Then I would go to becoming an author. I'd like to ask the question, please, why is the title Failed Unpublished Author a job prerequisite to teach writing to a college level? I like to read. I like books. I'm a little skittish about literature. Do you have to wear a tie when you read it? Can you read it in your underwear? Is it okay to laugh at the silly bits? How can you read Charles Baudelaire, for example, without resorting to a belly laugh? I never could. Of course, I never could pull off the black beret and the turtleneck sweater either. Apparently, that's what the real writers wear. I managed to be an author in spite of my education. Education is least experienced in it. Teaches you all you need to know to fail completely, utterly completely. I don't know about how many other countries manage to create equally dramatic failures if their educational system isn't as good as ours. Wouldn't it be nice if there was a college diploma you could get in success? You start with success 101, question everything, and end up at success 499. Create something of value. Sign me up. So looking back, the kind of manual that you would have liked to have had when you were born helped me achieve success in my life. One to emphasize the great the world that you live in. We're making this up too, you know. One to emphasize that you create the world you live in. We're making this up, you know. One to emphasize that each person, including me, has to take responsibility for their life, and that life isn't absolutely delirious blissful, that a person is authorized by the highest authority to change it. I like the chapter on social norms, and I want a ball on the chain that they can... I'd like the chapter on social norms, and I want a ball and chain they can be if you let them. Miserable people want you to join them, but you can choose not to. If the invitation says black tie and you're feeling tie-dye, go for it. If the part Texas I'm from white cowboy hats must not wear after Labor Day, then you must wear your black one. I say be daring. Wear your white bat on Christmas Day. Wear your white hat on Christmas Day if you want to. If you're successful enough, you'll start a trend. I want the manual to say your job is to be outrageously creative and successful. My job is to be outrageously creative and successful and happy. And that's it. End of the story. All the work, ethic stuff, guilt stuff, fear stuff, all that, that's not for you. That's not for you, and it can be a success or happy endings. Working 1 hour a year, so go for it. It's okay with the universe. And at the end of the manual, a certificate, a nice one, with all the embroidered gold seal saying, you are hereby authorized to do whatever you feel. Have the guts to try. You are hereby notified. Don't ever have to ask anyone's permission to be successful or happy at anything. If you think you can do it, do it. You're authorized by the power vested in your own soul, as evidenced by this certificate, to live your dreams to the max now. I'd mount that certificate on the wall proudly, wouldn't you? What's that got to do with success? Most people are for failures, aren't they? Most people are failures, aren't they? They work all week at a job that they hate for their entire lives, and then they try to forget who they are on the weekend until they go back to that same job and hate Monday morning? What people really do to live their lives in quiet desperation, then die without having ever lived? If you do what most people do, then you'll have the results most people get. If you want something other than the obvious to happen, then you need to do something other than the obvious, and you need to do it now. Pat O'Brien is an internationally famous blues guitarist and international marketing celebrity. See www.patobrien.com. Only you can diminish your self-esteem, and only you can restore it. Freedom comes with non-attachment to whatever another says or does. Dr. Joe Rubino. Ode l'écoute d'ignom. Ode l'écoute d'ignom. Ode l'écoute d'ignom. I discovered a 16th century Latin phrase that speaks to the whole issue of goal setting. Ode l'écoute d'ignom. It translates to mean, dare something worthy. Oh, how it conjures up the noblest within us to dare something worthy, to dare something worthy, dare something worthy. When you think about daring something worthy, you get past your ego and your limitations. You start to think about the world and helping others. You have a goal of losing a few pounds or making some more money, getting a raise at your job. Those are all valid goals. But a goal does dare something. Something worthy will be bigger. It makes you become achiever. Time fitnesses levels for you. Or to break all known records for your business. Or to start to achieve a dream that affects your planet. When you dare something worthy, you tap into all energies within yourself. You align yourself with the universe desire to grow. Dare something worthy and you unlock the powers of yourself and all that is. Dare something worthy and you feel your heart sing. Dare something worthy today. Life's Missing Instruction Manual, the guidebook you should have been given at birth. Joe Vitale.